If you are receiving this transmission, you are the resistance declaring war on the New World Order. TruthRadioShow.com. Okay, we are live. This is Dan Bedondi. I'm with my brother Jason. We're at the American Stonehenge in Salem, New Hampshire. So I'll just give you a little video here. We just got out of the... Hang on a second. Live. So that's the where you come in, pay your price, whatever. So this is the beginning of the trails of these ancient mountains. Artifacts out here. So we're live with Jason Bedondi. So we're in Salem, New Hampshire at the American Stonehenge. So hopefully the live stream lasts. What's up, Diana? American Stonehenge, Salem, New Hampshire. Happy Shabbat, Diana. So I was just talking to the manager over here that runs the operation. They very much know about the giants, the mountains, and all that other stuff. The guy I was talking to, he's been on 300 talk shows talking about these ancient ruins, the giants, and all that. So we're coming up on some of the ancient sites there. Some rock formations. We're also looking for mountains too. We're going Nephilim hunting.
Hoping to have the broken down milkman with us.
What's up, Mark?
These hills are gonna kill me,
man. Yeah, the hills are gonna kill me. Get the shovels.
We may have to blast.
Let's go in it. So we're going in.
Oh, it doesn't go anywhere. That's pretty awesome.
What's up, Cody? We're in Salem, New Hampshire at the American Stonehenge. So it's one of the old, some kind of a structure. This is probably a grave before that was what it was. As you can see, this is a mound. And obviously they dug it out, whatever, opened up the tomb. Well, that or a nice shelter, but I really believe that this was a, a grave. A Nephilim grave, probably. Hang on, let me go in there because I want to see if there's... You got a flashlight on you? Let's see if there's any markings on the walls. Yeah, with Jason Bidondi. So what I try to squeeze through here. Oh, it's something right here, 1981. Hang on, let me get in here. Definitely getting dirty today. Somebody carved it in my... Just trying to see if there's any markers. So this is probably a Nephilim tomb, that's what it is. Or a nice shelter. But that's what it looks like on the outside. Yeah, so we're inside of one of the mounds here. Yeah, they probably dug it out, that's why it's open. And of course the Smithsonian, somebody confiscated the evidence and let me get a picture here. We're inside of a mound. I feel like a giant here myself. 320 pound wrestler inside of a tiny mound here. Well, it's not that tiny, it's pretty roomy in there. Out of here. It's probably one of many. Again, this is what it looks like here on the outside. Yeah, it's the same story. The guy who runs the place here, he was telling us that every time the Smithsonian or Historical Society will confiscate the evidence, and of course there's nowhere to be seen because they claim it's lost or stolen afterwards.
Also on the lookout for Cumberland.
Oh yeah. There's Cumberland Knight up here that puts a... I imagine because this was Wampanoag land too, so... So those just joined us were in Nashville, I'm sorry, Salem, New Hampshire at the America's Stonehenge. That looks like a mound over there too. Is that a trail or could we just walk over there? Mm-hmm. There's something over there. He said that people spend like an average of about an hour to walk through this. So that means it'll take us 3 hours to walk this. What's going on, Norm? What's up, Claudette? There's another one up there, too. Probably should have stuck to the trail because it probably eventually go around anyway. Alright, it's just regular rocks over here. So out here is a bunch of ancient ruins. What's up, Joanne? Shabbat Shalom. The other thing, to the average person, they don't know what they're looking at when they come up here. That's why they just zip through here, because they have no clue. Looks like the rock from the Goonies. If it's the bloom, I'll show you it, Trevor. What's up, Mary? What's that K up there? Shabbat Shalom, sister. Mayday Monolith. Oh, I forgot to grab the brochure with the has the letters on it, what they mean. Oh, you got it? Look what K means. Oh, Mayday, there it is right there.
Mayday Monolith.
That's all it says.
The largest known sunrise monolith on the site.
So this is a sunrise monolith right here. According to the information here.
I thought there was going to be like a bunch of stones, like stone.
Seen some pictures of things like that. Actually, let's go. Is that one over there? Because I think we cut the path. Yeah, we're going the opposite way. Like I said, we just cut across just to get back on track, just in case we don't miss anything. What's up, Jim? Wish Brian was here. That'd be awesome. Don't worry, we got our Nephilim. Should have brought the Nephilim
killer right there.
Oh, the big feathers. That's a big owl or something.
What they used to use in the olden days to write with.
Yeah.
Dip what's up, John? In the ink and...
John Noons, what's up, bro? Is that science? The V-shaped cutout, we believe, was used like a gun to view the sunrise, which was one of the ancient Celtic holidays. What's N say? November for us? Jason? What does N mean? It says November for us sunrise. Salem, New Hampshire.
Yeah. November 1st sunrise.
That's all it says.
The line with November 1st sunrise. Note the V-shaped notch at the edge of the way to the top of the stone.
Huh. Something over here too. This is a burnt stone. You know, when you come to places like this is just like solid proof that everything you got taught in school is a bunch of bull. The pilgrims landed here and Columbus discovered America. That's a load of baloney. It's clear evidence that the Vikings are here hundreds of years before the Norse, the Celtics, and all them. They're already here hundreds of years before Columbus was even thought of.
Way back, a thousand years ago, is the Minoans from the island of Crete.
The what?
The Minoans from the island of Crete. They came here to mine tons of copper, which was used to start the Bronze Age. I'm joking.
It's a camera.
There is no climbing of walls or structures. What fun is that?
I think I'm looking at them. If you're wondering, yes, I'm definitely prayed up before I got here. The potty. Let me get a picture of that. Ah, my knee. Tax up to 14. Any markings on the walls? We're inside of a Nephilim mound.
This could be another contributing factor to the paranormal activity.
Oh yeah, the crystal would.
Quartz crystals there.
Yeah, because they wouldn't do the rituals.
Not seen any common right yet. Kumbo night is like a rusty brown color.
Yeah, it's magnetic too. Did you bring a magnet or a compass? I forgot my compass. Jason's got everything in that bag. Yeah, another flat earth nut. Well, the evidence is overwhelming, man. So with the Cumberlandite, that compass would spin. Which sea? Let me see that paper. Jason's all geared up.
Just hold on to it for now.
So let us see, they give you a paper of what these things mean. No, we don't want to be in. So, C means, what is it, secret bed, a narrow niche large enough for a person to crawl into. So, that's what the C means over there. How's it going, guys?
Good, how are you?
All right. Yeah. Going Nephilim hunting. It's pretty awesome.
My GoPro she got wigged out on me.
I think you need another one. Number 22. 22 is drain exit. The drain was cut into a bedrock like many others on site. Some carrot. No, I don't want to be on video. Oh, get the hell out of the way. Oh, look at that. It's awesome. Of course, we're going in. So we're inside of a little east-west chamber, three-section chamber similar to the ancient European structures called the galley graves. There's only one with the east-west right to the doorway, and all the other chamber openings on the site face south. And 20 over here coming up from 1978 to 1980. Goodwin's foot. Oh, all right, that's the mug. So the same is like a burial chamber, like. Awesome. Hey John, I'm a flat earth nut too. 24 27. The Oracle Chamber. Let me get some pictures.
D and C and A, C, D, D, F.
Hold on 1 second. Let me see your light for a second. Well, read what that means. C, D, and F. Okay, I got my hands on the thing. Hold on, guys, we're in some oracle chamber. Yeah, 28. This is the largest chamber in the site of testing here, also. So we're inside the. Losing connection. You want to go through this way, too? Huh? This is another passage over here. I'm going to let these people pass. There's other people here. Hold on a second.
Okay. I'm going to pass it to Rihanna.
Look for any markings and stuff. They've never been found or returned to the site. Although this may look like a chimney, Hang on, wait for them to leave.
Yeah, I don't think you go down that way anyway.
Oh. Got it. As soon as you get out of there.
Yeah, you can't get out that way. It's just a hole in the roof. Oh, so you have to go down this way.
Oh, look at spider. Hey spider. It's a little wee vent here. Yep.
You have to go this way to go around.
Hmm?
You have to go this way to go around.
Oh. I'm gonna go through that one more time, Jason. It's a good video.
Put the light on.
I forgot how to put the light on. Oh, there it is. Does the light work anymore? You just had it. Oh, there it is. So I was gonna go back in here quick. Just get on video. That's pretty awesome. This is supposed to be the Oracle Chamber. A lot of people say there's a lot of paranormal activity in here. And I know a guy who's a Indian medicine man. He said he got attacked by demons in this place. And my buddy Jeremy, who's a paranormalist, he said the energy is like off the scale in this place. That's because it's an ancient area, and you got a lot of Nephilim spirits up here. And I'll say it again: if you're not sanctified by the blood of Christ, that's when they attack you. Oh, here's a chamber here. It's pretty awesome. Yeah, it all looks crazy. And on video, well, you see it with your own eyes, it's like eye awakening. So I don't wonder why some of these schools still teach the Columbus garbage. Return to trail and lodge. I think the trail's over here. This is the top view from it.
They're talking about a sacrifice too.
Hmm?
Sign says something about a sacrifice.
Where? Sacrificial table? That's not good. Where is it? That must be it over there.
The arrow is pointing.
Oops, wet chain. I think I found it over here. Some of these tunnels. So one of these is supposed to be the sacrificial chamber. Table, I mean, where they did sacrifices on. Oh, 90 degree hole. This slab is 190 degree to the... Trying to see where the... No.
I think they removed it.
See what 15 is. Quarry post socket. Where are you just over there? Oh, that's probably where it is. Yeah, we just already went through those. 17, 18.
Curves like that. Do
we pass it over here or something? We were already over there. It's probably a lot we're gonna miss because so many little markers and stuff.
Section up here.
I'm going to have the guy on my show, the guy who runs the place here. He's been on 300 talk shows. He knows Ali Mazzulli. You know, the guys that do this kind of stuff. He's been on George Norrie's Coast to Coast. So he was very well aware of the giants, the Nephilim Mountains and all that stuff. We had a good conversation. Letters, eh? It's the roof may be served as a base for fireplace. And if you guys go look at the layout of this place, the pass, you got straight lines coming out of a circle. It's the same almost formation as the Grand Canyon. Kind of crazy. That's right, with God's warriors. There's a wall here surrounding something. Maybe go up there. Let me look down this way first. There you go. See, we got things like this out in Rhode Island too. See, it's the serpent wall. The guy was telling us about the serpent mounds. I would love for people that doubt the Bible, doubt the giants and things like that to come to these places. Especially the dumb evolutionists. Things like this just destroy evolution doctrine. That's why the Smithsonian and Historical Society always confiscate remains of giants and everything. Because they all have to explain to the public that, yeah, we didn't evolve from the apes.
We are live.
See, which is White Solstice Sunset Monolith. So, see, it says, a secret bed, a narrow niche large enough for a person to crawl into. Yeah, I don't think I'm crawling to that. Let me get a picture. Crawl into what? It says something narrow enough to crawl into. I don't see anything you can crawl into. Unless they covered it up. Oh, I think it's right there. Well, going in. What does that say? The stuff that's usually blocked off is probably the good stuff. I'll be going anyway.
Okay, that's wildlife stuff.
So. Oh.
I can respect that.
Hmm?
I can respect that.
Yeah.
They have wildlife here.
After this, we're going to go visit Brother Bill O'Connell. Working at the gas station in Boston. We should stop in Salem, too, if we get a chance. They'll probably burn us at the stake over there. February 1st sunset. So this is how smart these people were, these ancients. They marked everything, the date, the months, where the sun would set and the sun would rise. They didn't need a cell phone to do that. So the stone steps, these steps led into a courtyard once surrounded by several structures. So this once was a courtyard here with several structures here that once stood here. They got that little cheat sheet there. It's cool because they have a tour guide on the phone you can download. And you know, it's like GPS and everything, so it helps you walk through the path and tells you what's what. You click on it and it tells you, which I should have done that. But I'm just doing the old-fashioned way here. So this whole area was a courtyard here, a bunch of structures.
Now what do you say, is he leaving that too, or he gets there?
Gets there too. Yeah, he'll be there all night. so I'm covered in sweat. It's hot up here. What's going on, Ben? What's up, everybody? Seeing everybody in the comments.
Very muggy.
Yeah, it's very muggy. What's up, Crisco and Diana, Joanne? What's going on, everybody? So again, live in Salem, New Hampshire at the America Stonehenge. Let's go over there because I want to see what's down that valley. See, me and my brother, me and my brother were the type that used to get a bunch of kids to bunk school with us. And what we do, instead of going hang out at somebody's house, we would go on adventures deep into the woods, into tunnels, down railroad tracks, always getting chased by the cops, or getting into some, you know, quirky adventure. You know what I mean? And yeah, so that's what we did as kids. We didn't go on dates and, you know, that much and do all that stuff. What we did is we're, you know, while teenagers going on dates with people, we were into tunnels in the middle of nowhere, you know, exploring things, crawling through water and spiders and all that garbage. So we lived there like the Indiana Jones Goonies life. That is funny, huh? Remember, Claude, you guys should be out dating, man. Never mind going through tunnels and sewage and whatever the heck that comes a long way.
Yeah,
exactly. So if you're young out there, guys, you got all your life to date or whatever. You know, stuff like this, you can't beat at all. It's a lifetime of memories.
Plus you want to do it while you're young and have the energy, too.
Yeah. That's why we always encourage people to go out exploring because, I got like lifetime of memories like you'll never forget. And I didn't spend money going doing stupid things, smoking weed or any of that like that, getting drunk. We used to go out in the middle of nowhere to 3-4 in the morning. Go on expeditions for a whole weekend sometime when we didn't have school. And our mother's like, yeah, have fun. So me and my brother, my uncle, a couple of my cousins, a bunch of our friends, and whoever else we dragged along. And yeah, most of the time, granted, you probably got bruises and broken bones or whatever the heck, but it was fun, you know. What's going on, Sal? I'm up in New Hampshire at the America Stonehenge. Sal Caiozzo.
Sal Rosas.
Jason's with me. Say what's up, Sal.
Go on, Sal.
We should have probably brought Sal with us. I didn't even think about that. Next time we come, I'll bring you Sal if you want. He's probably already been up here. Yeah, we just passed some ruins, so we're going on to some more.
Ruins.
Ruins.
That's what he says. Ruins.
I'm excited to interview the manager here. Yeah, the manager, we were talking about giant serpent mounds. It's like, wow, it's like awesome. There's one over there.
Brian, you should be with us, man.
All right, Brian's on it. In the, yep.
Well, we'll see what you
I have to go down to Kentucky and get him. So we should be coming up on some more of these soon. Let's look around off the path too, because you know these people they don't show you everything. So. Reminds me of the monastery.
Well, the structure is much older than the monastery because it's the other places are connected.
Yeah.
This place ain't connected at all to any of that. There's no there's none of that like material, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
There's no man-made material and there's no haven't found any freaking
I think they did that to cover up a lot of the holes.
But it's in every other site.
Yeah.
Well, this is definitely the oldest spot in the country.
We should stop in Salem. Let's go filming from the Satanic Temple. Jesus is Lord. get them all wild up. Bunch of cowards up there. The guy who runs it is some cockeyed guy named Lucius Greaves. He's the one that founded the Satanic Temple.
He used to be a cross-eyed gunner.
Coming up to some stuff now. Hey, Brian, what's up, man? So we're at the American Stonehenge. I tried to call you earlier. So we went through a couple of these little chambers and everything already. So we're walking the pathway now to find more.
Brian, you should be with us.
Ooh, a turkey. Get the shotgun. Hey, Brian, the guy who runs this place here, he's been on over 300 talk shows. He knows Ellie Mazzulli and all these guys. He was sitting there telling me about, he's been all over the country, and he used to be a pilot too, but serpent mounds, Nephilim mounds, giants and everything else. So he's very well aware of that. So he gave me his contact. So if you want him on the show too. So it's gonna be pretty awesome. Hang on a second. Where's the rest of these?
These trails are gonna kill me.
Hey Brian, if you spot something, because I know you got an eye for this stuff too.
Brian, keep your eye on the prize.
Brian's probably on Google Earth looking at us right now.
How do you get the live Google Earth?
You get some British company does it. Live radio you can use from satellites. I guess it's illegal here in the United States because of privacy things. But
I should go through.
Yeah, I'm breathing hard, up and down hills, and in our little tunnels.
I should try to go through Google Earth through the Tor browser. See if that works.
It's over here. Matt, oh no, no, I don't want to go through that. Every time you do that, you get us in trouble. It's funny because every time somebody hung out with us, they always got in trouble or hurt.
Hang out with us. If you don't get hurt, even more often, you're not having a good time.
Yeah, if you don't get hurt or in trouble with us, you're not having a good time. Ryan Reese.
Broken down milkman.
Brian should drive up here. Take the company Learjet. Yeah, I wish we had one of those. Imagine if we had a jet like that. Go all over the country exploring and stuff.
Put that milk truck in four-wheel drive.
Yeah. Hey, how you doing, man? Do you know where the rest of the monuments are?
Yeah, you gotta go back up here and take a left.
Yep.
You go back up to the winter solstice. The north stone is right over here. I'm gonna go up here. I'm gonna go in there and lead back anyway.
All right. Yeah, we went off the path.
Good.
Just up around the corner here. You go right back in.
cool.
So that raise was the first quartz slab we ever found back in 1982.
Yep.
It's actually raised up, dropped, and in the edge of it was serrated by hammer stones.
Oh, wow.
Shaping it, what they call percussion flaking.
Yep.
But these things are all over the hilltop. There's some that go 1,000 feet from here that are the same kind of big slabs that were quarried and being shaped or dressed, probably to go on the main site as some sort of construction, like a roof slab, probably.
Yep.
It's that stone right there. And there are bigger ones out there, too. It's in my book. I wrote a new book. It took 5 years to put the book together.
Yeah.
And we finally finished it up just in time for the equinox, and that's when Scott came. My book just came out that week that Scott came out with Haley to do the 2 day thing.
Yep.
So my book, their books are, you know, they had their books and my books on the table. They're selling them, but this is one of the. So she sat here in 82 on the edge of this heavier picnic lunch and noticed a stone here.
Yep.
The stone's been stuck under there. They raised it up, they propped it. The stone is a few inches this way from its original socket. They actually excavated back there. And this has been excavated too back in 1983. And the edge of this has a little dimpling on it along the edge here where they must have been striking it with a stone to shape it. And this is typically would go into a roof slab. And there are 34 of these all over the 110 acres. And we're going to GPS all of them.
Mm.
And in my book, I have another one. And you think it's the same stone, but it's probably maybe like 40% bigger or something. It goes out to here. It's even a bigger stone than that. That's about 1,000 feet that way.
Oh.
And some of the stones are as big as the one my foot is on. So it's smaller ones.
Mm-hmm.
Down by the watch house is one. They always have these propping stones under them. And then they would dress the stone or shape it using percussion flaking. Dr. Gary Hume, the state archaeologist, he started in 76 part-time with the state of New Hampshire, doctor of archaeology, and then it became a full-time job in 1980, and that's when he joined us. And Dave Stewart Smith joined us in 1978. He had just returned from England working over there in some of the megalithic sites and medieval sites. He's from Connecticut originally, went over there for 6 years in England, worked for what is called English Heritage today. Mm-hmm. Back then it was called the Ancient Monuments Commission or whatever. So when he came back home to New England, he was quite surprised these sites existed over here.
Oh.
And in the state of Connecticut, it's loaded with these sites like Gungie Wampton and Rotten, you know.
Have you found any Cumulonite up here?
Any
Cumulonite?
No, I think that's more in the Narragansett Bay on one of the islands here. Dave, I think Scott Walters gets into that. He's a geologist.
He's got a 100-pound piece of it.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Did you say you talked to Scott?
Long time ago.
See, that's because he's a geologist.
Yeah.
I found that the Cumulonimbus site, it's a big rock.
That's an interesting story. I think Scott gets into that whole thing about that type of stone, and I think a piece of it is in the new...
Yeah, he asked about the stone, and also it's a Wamsutta on one of the cornerstones. It's like kind of red. It's a Wamsutta stone that's made in Smithfield, Rhode Island.
Smithfield, yeah. And I think that's where Dave lived in Smithfield, I think, for a while. And his name is Smith, you know, David Stewart Smith. But he ended up in Webster, New Hampshire, and he played the bagpipes. He had a recording studio. He had a doctorate in historical anthropology. He was a certified archaeologist by Dr. Bradstreet from Maine. He worked under him. But he was a doctor. He had a doctorate in theology, too. I think that was an honorarium. But he went back to Scotland many times, towards the end of his life. He'd go to England, go up to Scotland. And he had a farm up north, too, like I mentioned. But he was our researcher for almost 40 years, and he was a NERA researcher for many, many years, too. But this is the kind of thing that he showed Dr. Gary Hume. And Gary Hume's still alive, actually. So, in fact, he was going to visit us when Pat Hume came in. Pat Hume was our archaeologist, same name. They know each other. She was married to a doctor of geology that was at Tufts for 30 years, and everybody thinks they're married, but they're not. It was Dr. James Hume. Geologist, Dr. Gary Hume's an archaeologist, so they were both very, very helpful and resourceful.
What's the name of your book, by the way?
It's called America Stonehenge, or Stone Ruins of New Hampshire.
And what's your full name?
Dennis Stone.
Dennis Stone. I can't wait to get you on the show, man. It's going to be great.
Yeah, the book came out just in time for the equinox, and we worked on it for 5 years, and the book before that we put out was the was our souvenir book in 2018. My daughter helped me with another staff member, and then that went pretty smoothly and pretty quickly. We got into this a real, you know, book on the site, and it took 5 years because my daughter-in-law helped me edit it, and then she had our granddaughter, so that kind of tied her up, and then we had COVID, and she took time off from COVID with a baby, so it got slowed down. And then James Lacefield, our manager, he's been with us for 5 years now, actually 6 years. He was here in 2018 in high school, then he went through college, got a degree in law enforcement, and graduated top of his class, and he was a school editor, one of his school editors, so he helped me finish the book.
Cat
helped me start it, he helped me finish it, and push input from the staff. It took a lot longer to do it than we thought because we kept finding things. We found more of these. We found serpent walls, and we found windows all over the hilltop. And then we had DNA on some bones done just last year by L.A. Mazzulli. He actually was part of that DNA. Wow. He had the same laboratory on the Paraca skulls he used up in Thunder Bay, Canada, at Lake Point University, I believe it's called. And then he was involved with the carbon dating of it. And we used our old geochrome laboratories we used since 1967, and the son's running the laboratory now. It was Dr. Harold Kruger, and his son Dana's running it. And we contacted him and said, these bones were found back in the 1930s by Mr. Goodwin. They've been out of the ground for over 80, 85 years.
Wow.
He goes, they should be fine, the carbon today. I said, oh, I thought they got contaminated by the outside environment. He goes, no, I said, wow, that's a misnomer then. Because so he took three bones that were found by Mr. Goodwin, 1968, brought to the Smithsonian. They were looked at by Dr. Lucille St. Hoyen. I hope I have her name right. She was a physical anthropologist. She said, I believe these are human. These three bones appear to be human. No DNA back in those days. Then two other bones that came out of the watch house were shown to her. I mean, she had them there, and because we sent this woman from New Hampshire, a school teacher, drove them to the Smithsonian in Washington. And they were down there for whatever, and then they were shipped back, and we had a sign for them. But anyway, the other two bones that came out of the watch house, she looked at them and thought they were bison or buffalo. Goes, wow. So she showed him to a male colleague who was more of an animal specialist, and he looked at him and said, yeah, I believe these are bison. Now, we haven't had DNA done on those, but they were found inside the watch house, and she said he was not surprised that bison would be in this area. The woodland bison were here at in prehistoric, I mean, in very ancient times. So it'd be kind of cool to carbon date them too and check if they are buff. But why would they be in the chamber? Were they some sort of an offering? I don't know. But in there, it was also a stone. Shaped like the summer solstice sunrise stone. It looks like a little mini version of that with a hole drilled in it. And a bone about this big with a hole drilled in it. They were both found in that watch house too. They have not been, the bone has not been DNA'd or carbon dated, but we think they're pendants. They were, we think, left in there as offerings. And maybe the buffalo bones are left in there as offerings too inside the watch house. So we have been doing DNA recently. We've done the more carbon dating. The laboratory in Mass actually sent the bone. We only had one bone because it's $700 a piece. We had three bones. We kept one. We sent two to the laboratory in Canada. They reduced it because they had to use some of it for DNA testing, so you get back part of the bone. And then one of those was actually sent to Mass. I brought it to Massachusetts to the laboratory in Tewksbury. Then they sent it to the University of Arizona in Tucson, and they did the Mass Accelerator Spectrometry. 4 months later, we got the results back. But the DNA on these two, on these three human bones, actually on two of the three, and they were found together, were that these two were related very closely, same person or family, and they matched it against 39,500 samples, and it turns out it was Greek ancestry. I'm like, wow, that's interesting, because the Patty family were from England, and it could have been Greek people here. We just don't have any record of that, so it's kind of kind of weird. And then what time period? Well, the time period, the carbon dating said 1690 A.D., up to about 1900 with the medium date 1850, and that's when Jonathan died. But we don't know him having any. These people are Greek, you know.
Yeah.
So it's kind of what it did. It added to the question of why would a human body be left on top of the site on the bedrock with just a thin layer of soil just to decompose. You know, if an animal brought the bones in, it would probably be from these bones were from different parts of the body. So unless it dragged a whole body up here, an animal from some graveyard down the street, it makes no sense to us at all.
Or did it could have been a sacrifice or something?
Well, this is in the 16th. They're Christians. In fact, Patty was involved with one of the churches. I'm trying to think if it was, what church was it now? Not the Lutheran, not Baptist. It was one of the churches. He was involved with that. So they're Christian people. I don't think they would have been sacrificing anybody. And the fact that this bone... these bones were here during the time that they were around. It's kind of weird. Why would they just let somebody decompose, man or woman? Why would you let them you know, rot out on
unless they were dragged, like you said.
Yeah, but the problem is they're three different parts of the body.
Oh.
If it was one bone on an animal, like my dog will pick up a bone, you know, unless they're going to drag the whole body from down, nearest grave is like over a quarter of a mile away. It doesn't add up.
You know?
So these bones were cool. Elliot was involved with that. But they weren't ancient. They were just old, you know. So these type of stones here are the quarried slabs, and this is how they basically made their stone slabs that were used for stone monoliths with jasper-nomical alignments, the roof slabs, the wall slabs in the east-west chamber, they call them orthostats, big stones with roofs on top of them, or the sacrificial table. But also, we have windows, 28 windows in these stone walls, and they're all over the hilltop here. These are windows about roughly this big, but they're in various sizes. There are holes to the wall. Not just a hole, though, they have like lintel, like a flat slab generally, various thicknesses, and a sill, and they have a hole. Some of them have stone shutters, and some of them have stone shutters piled up like Venetian blinds, and four of them have stone cobbles, two or three cobbles set inside the hole. They're not supporting the roof of that lintel, they're just in there. And when we found out that North Stonington, Connecticut has 8,000 of these features, 35,000 acres, and we found that out in book came out in 2016, and I had found my first serpent wall in my first windows in 2016 in the spring. As a matter of fact, Scott Walters was here with a group, and it was Alan Butler from England. He's been on History Channel many times. Alan was here with his wife. Scott was here with his wife, and there's a whole bunch of us, and I showed them my first couple serpents in the spring of 2016, and I said, this is very amazing, you know? They were pretty impressed by that. Scott, in the meantime, had already done a show about the Serpent Mound in Ohio, and in Scotland, there's a stone wall shaped like a serpent in Scotland. It's one of his episodes. So he was already familiar with that. But when I found out North Stonington has over 400 serpent walls alone, and they go from 30 feet up to 300, the average is 100, and they're linear, rectilinear, like a head like this, or a tail like this. Some are shaped like this, like an S, and others kind of loop around. And on this site, we have three that look like they're biting the tail, which is called the Ouroboros.
Ouroboros, yep.
Yep, and we have three of those. And as time went on during this 2016, 17, and 18, and up to today, we have found, in fact, this year we had a camera crew. I mean, a gentleman that's a producer for Prime and for Showtime. He's a movie producer. In fact, he's on a movie shoot right now. He came up with his family last summer, drove all the way out from Kansas City, Missouri, came up here and introduced himself, did the most beautiful drone work I've ever seen. And he wants, with another producer, put together an ancient mysteries documentary, and we'll be part of that. He came back up when Scott came up this spring. He wanted to interview Scott. He's been wanting to for years, so I arranged that. So he flew up. He actually stayed with us, and he took us all, you know, we all went out to dinner and everything, Scott and everybody. We all had a nice evening, but he was here for 2 days filming, and filmed Haley and filmed Scott. He filmed me again, although he had already done me the previous year. But that day he was up here Friday before the event. Saturday and Sunday were the event we did with Scott and everything. I did my PowerPoint. Scott did his. Haley did it. And we were supposed to have Ronnie LeBlanc here. And Ronnie LeBlanc is from Ghost Hunters. Expedition Bigfoot. Expedition Bigfoot. He's one of the four hosts of Travel Channel. He's been on that for about 4 or 5 years. And I met Ronnie. He's been here with his daughter. He introduced me at a conference 5 years ago. It was very, very nice, you know. And in fact, he reached out to me last fall and said, I'd like to do something. And I found out about the Scott thing. But what happened is he had an emergency at 3:30 in the morning. Something happened in his family. So he let Haley and the rest of us know that he couldn't attend. So that was kind of sad. We didn't get to have Ronnie. And he would have, you know, been with the rest of us up here. So anyway, that day on Friday, this guy, Jason Hudson from Kansas City, was walking around with James in the morning on Friday. This is before any of the activities took place the day before. And they actually, I joined him midday, and we found another serpent wall right in front of him. And James, prior to that, had found another window that day. Wow. That was back, I would say March 20th or something like that, just before the big event took place, the 2-day event with Scott and Haley. And so that's, you know, we're still finding stuff here. But North Stonington has 8,000 different structures, 25 categories of structures. And the author wrote the book in 2016 called Ceremonial Stonework. And his name is Malcolm Starr. He's been here a couple of times. I met him down at a lecture in 17 in Groton, Connecticut, near Gungeewomp. And he was going to speak. I saw his book on the counter, but I didn't recognize it at first. I'm like, what book is this? You know, that were for sale?
Yeah.
That cover talks about 8,000 structures. And I said, oh, it must be the whole Northeast. But it turns out it was just that one town in North Stonington.
Oh, wow.
And he categorized different features into 25 categories. And we have just about every category here on the site, whether it's a chamber, a standing stone, an orthostat, a big slab on its side, Carnes, chambered Carnes. We had four Carnes. We have two remaining Carnes today. And then you get into the serpent walls, and I'm like, and I saw that before we spoke. I'm like, that's what we got here, you know? I was like, Wow. And he mentions he has 400 of them. The windows, and he's got a few different pictures of the windows. And I'm like, that's what we got here, too. My friend Maria Wheatley from England is very well aware of that. And after we did a couple podcasts together 4 or 5 years ago, and I still talk, she was just talking to me this week by messenger. She's coming out here next May to do an event up here for 2 days. Oh, wow. She's in Chaco. She's going to be in Chaco pretty soon. Mm-hmm. She was just in Egypt not too long ago and in Malta, which we've been to. So she does these lectures all over, and she goes to Sedona, Arizona, that big mythological, really cool, yep. You know. So, but anyway, she sends me pictures of her windows in Dartmoor, England, and they call them soul holes. They think the spirits flow through them, maybe over there, maybe over here too. And then recently, this year, she's been sending me pictures of serpent walls in England. I was aware of Scots in Scotland. Here it is in England, serpentine walls. I'm like, you know, I've been in England numerous times, but never knew that, you know.
Are they connected to here and over in Kentucky area too? The serpent mounds out there too?
Well, this is stone walls that are shaped like snakes.
Yeah.
Just like we have here.
Yeah.
But the serpent, I mean, they do have mounds, obviously, like Silbury Mound in England, which I've been to. It looks like the Grave Creek Mound, you know, and also like Miamisburg Mound in Ohio, where they look so similar. Not only a big mound, and they're kind of structured, but they have a bank and ditch around them. And the ones down, like the one at Grave Creek, it's almost completely illuminated. It's wiped out, but it had a bank and ditch around the bottom, like Silbury Hill does. And Silver Hill is the biggest of all of them, but Grave Creek's pretty big, and Miamisburg, which we went by, we didn't get a chance to stop and see that one in Ohio. They look like twins, you know. But the serpentine walls, they're in Kentucky. A woman down there, 1990, did a report on a wall, and I just recently talked to people that have seen it, and they said, yeah, it's very, very treacherous. It's kind of steep. I don't know. I didn't do it, but they said it's very difficult getting a lot of brush. It's in a very hard to reach area, and I don't know if you get there. I'm like, well, this isn't bad, but it does sound like it might be a. Well, her serpent is a stone wall, and it had a big open mouth like that.
Wow.
And that's the one down by the lower well where we have the south wall. We call it the south wall since the 1970s because it's true south and north. It runs straight through the platform through the north stone alignment. We think that's a serpent. And it has a wall like this at the end near the lower well, like this, if you look at it. And then it kind of goes over here with the wall. I think what we have... And in the middle of it is a boulder, and I think that might represent pregnancy or it ate its prey. We have several of those in Connecticut. Some of the walls of the serpent's body get wider, and then it goes back to a narrower body. They think, again, with the walls, they added more rocks, and they made this like a bulge. Again, is that pregnancy? Is that it ate its prey? But they do exist in Connecticut.
Yeah.
They are in the Hudson Valley. They are in Pennsylvania. And the Berkshires of Massachusetts near, I mentioned Jim, here, right down in that area, there's serpent walls, and they have windows inside the serpents too. And the thing here, we have 28 windows, we have 15 serpent walls, we believe, our best guess. Some of the windows are in the serpent's bodies. There are a couple walls here, however, they have the windows that, I don't know if they represent a serpent, it's not obvious if that's what they were trying to do.
You said those windows now, though, what the souls go through? The spirits, is that where the looks like it's a pregnancy or something?
No, not necessarily. No, just us. But some of the serpents do have the windows. But that the one on the south wall, right by the chain link fence, is a glacial rock. It's just natural. But they used it as part of the body, and it's like this, and then the body goes back to that shape.
Yeah.
I think it was intentionally done like that so they'd have an indication of pregnancy, perhaps, birth, fertility. But it could be also it ate its prey. You know, cause serpents do that. Snakes biting their tail. I've even seen pictures of real snakes. I don't know why they do that. Why would you bite? It's like biting yourself in the foot. I don't know why they do, but they do that sometimes. And that can be wholesomeness, the circle of life in infinity. It also can be protection, the serpent. And on our medical staff, they either have a serpent or two and like healing powers.
Yeah.
But cobra by the Egyptians, you know, and there was a good serpent and there was a bad serpent. I think Winchet might have been the good one and there was another one that was bad or vice versa. But it's an Adam and Eve with a serpent in Lilith. There's also, St. Paddy driving out serpent worship in Ireland. And I've been to Ireland, but they didn't have any fossil record of serpents. So it was symbolic of driving out the old serpent worship, you know. So but serpents are worldwide. You go down to Mexico, we've been there a number of times. Kukulcan and Quetzalcoatl serpents. They go into South America. Mm-hmm. One thing up in the Northern Hemisphere, not, you wouldn't see it below the equator, I don't think. I haven't been below the equator yet, even though I flew for America. You don't see the constellation Draco. Yeah. And Draco kind of looks like a serpent, and that's one of the things that could have inspired these people.
Yeah.
4,000 years ago, its star Thuban, Alpha Draconis is the name of it. It's really not the brightest star in the constellation, though. It is right between the Little Dipper and Big Dipper. You can actually point out Thuban.
Yeah.
The Nurus axis is pointing at Polaris, part of the Little Dipper today.
Yeah.
But 4,000 years ago, the Earth's axis was pointing at Thuban. That was the pole star. So that would have been the part of the serpent's body. And at night, the serpent's body would have gone around that star like that. And the Egyptians saw that.
Yeah.
And it was a gateway to heaven.
It's pretty interesting because I did ancient serpent worship. I mean, it goes back thousands of years all over the world, basically.
Worldwide, yeah. You know. So, okay, it's serpents. Okay, which culture did... Many of them did.
Yeah.
So it doesn't really answer the question. But I'll tell you, my dad died in 09. And he went out and looked at these walls quite a bit, and he always was fascinated by the walls. Goodwin back in the 1930s was kind of, he had 20 acres. Some of this land we're on right now wasn't on Goodwin's 20 acres originally, but he knew these stones were out here as far as the standing stones.
Yeah.
And also he was interested in the walls, and the walls here, they turn, they twist and bend, usually agricultural walls, you know, field clearing, boundary, stock fence. Mm-hmm. The farmers started building all over New England starting in the 1700s. I guess before that, they used wooden fences. Even Plymouth Plantation, see a lot of wooden kind of, you know, like this kind of thing. But by the 1700s, they wanted to clear the fields, so you wouldn't hit the rocks with your plow. Every season, they come up with a frost. And then you want to make a boundary, of course, and maybe a stock fence to keep animals in or out, maybe all three, you know. And they say there's 240,000 miles worth of historic walls in New England. It's the most of anywhere in the world, even more than Ireland. I thought Ireland had a lot when I was there. But but there are walls that don't seem to be agricultural.
Yeah.
And again, one thing even Goodwin knew, and other researchers since the 1930s knew, the walls tend to bend, they turn, they twist. Farmers' walls are fairly straight. There are exceptions, but they tend to be fairly straight, generally speaking. But again, you can find some wig.
Yeah.
But when you see walls like ours, and they have big, big turns in them, big bends, and then they also, they just go from here, they run 30 or 40 feet, and they don't do anything. But one end might have like a boulder, and then you see the body taper down to a flat stone, like that's my first one I found in 2016 on a ridge of bedrock. And a lot of the ones in North Stonington, Connecticut are on the ridge of bedrock, just like my very first one. And it turns out it looks like a serpent. And I looked at it, I'm like, God, I'm looking at a snake here. And I had to start telling people because I didn't know what I had. I had no frame of reference. Turns out that they're in Vermont too, in a book called Manitou by Byron Dix. Byron Dix and James Maver Jr. wrote the book. They're both NERA members. The book came out in 89, and it was called Manitou, and it was Massachusetts and Vermont sites mainly. They might have mentioned a little Connecticut. Byron did a lot of work here, but they didn't really put this site in. You know, they really wanted to focus on the lesser-known sites.
Yeah.
And in the book, they do show windows. And actually, in Massachusetts, in that case, was down in Martha's Vineyard, and there are structures and dolmens there, but they show a window down there. And one of the pictures, when you pull up Manitou, and they call it a wind window back then. They didn't call it a soul hole or spirit window, but that's the thought today, that they were for spirits to flow through.
Mm.
I'm like, wow. And I read the book back in 89 or 90, right after it came out, and I never really caught that
when
you read it, because we didn't have anything to relate it to here. And the other thing is some of the twisty walls, too, and I think there were serpent walls.
Yeah.
They were onto that back in the 80s, you know, already.
Up in Como, we mentioned earlier, there's a couple of those walls that do twist and turn like that, so...
And you might be, if that's the case, it's possible to look at them a little closer and see if you're looking at something that could be serpentine in shape. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they undulate vertically, sometimes it's horizontally. We have one out near the winter solstice that does both. It not only turns left and right, but it goes up and down too. And that's pretty amazing. It's a really wide wall.
Yeah.
Stone walls generally here, for the most part, are one stone width.
Mm-hmm.
This is like multiple stones adjacent to each other.
Wow.
And the wall might be, I'd say close to 4 feet wide, but it does that and does that.
That's amazing.
And one end kind of goes up like it's a head.
Yeah.
And I showed it to Scott Walt and all these other people. I'm like, wow, look at that. You know, it's like, what farmer would build anything like that and go to that amount of work?
Yeah.
Moving all these stones to build something like that. It could have gone straight, and it only runs about, probably about 50 feet. And if you go past that, where it ends, where I think the head is, it's just bedrock and dirt. And then it's another wall that's shaped like a big arch. And that's where you watch the winter solstice sunset from. And it's a big arc wall. Again, it's a nice twisty kind of... Well, at the far end of it, I noticed in 2017, I think, possibly the end of 20... I should have wrote down the actual date. Oh, is it 16? Excuse me, because I know Dave Stewart Smith passed away in 2016, and I just showed him my first couple serpent walls and my first couple windows, and he was kind of like, whoa. He had pancreatic cancer, and he, you know, unfortunately passed away right after that. I wish we could have found it a few years before that, because he had great insight. He was a very, very knowledgeable guy, you know, and he could add some of his thoughts like he did on this stone here, you know, for instance, with Dr. Gary Hume and David Stewart Smith doing that project there. But that end of that wall has a beautiful window. It's the most beautiful, one of the prettiest windows we have. And I showed it to Dave. Dave walked over there. He goes, what the hell? He had to look at it carefully. He wanted to make sure one of our visitors didn't build it recently. So he looked at the lichens and mosses to make sure that you can tell where there's fresh rock and where it's all been sitting here forever covered. And it was not moved. And he goes, whoa. Even inside of it, you know, where all those spaces, he looked at it. He goes, how come we didn't see this? I says, I don't know, Dave, because you've been looking from this point on the other opposite end, about 30 feet away. That's where we've been standing to watch a winter solstice since actually 1967. And how could we never see a window on that side? It does bend, and there are big pine trees partially blocking it, which, you know, and there was brush there. So I'm thinking more like blueberry trees and brush blocked it, and people just didn't pay attention to it because their eyes weren't trained on looking for holes in the wall.
Yeah.
But you can't mistake it now. It's so, it's such, it make a postcard. It's so pretty. I got some really beautiful photographs of it, but it's one of the, I think it's like my second or third or fourth window I found here.
Nice. You know?
And then Dave saw it. If he could come back today, like my dad and all the other researchers that have passed, you know, they'd be kind of astonished. Dave Stewart Smith, we were already finding a few more of these stones too while he was alive. And this is 1982, like I mentioned, when they first found this. Today there are 34 of these, and they're all over the hilltop. Evidence that these people were building a much grander site, and then the work came to a stop. Almost like it was a work in progress.
Mm-hmm.
And just recently, in the last couple years, after we found number 34, I'm thinking there's so many of these all over the place that these people were still building the site, probably going to move these stones over to the main site and do more construction, and then they gave it up. And why did they do that? You know, what happened to these folks that were building this for probably many decades? Why did they walk away from the place? And then your thought goes to things like war, maybe disease, maybe some climate changes, I don't know. It's a possibility too that if this was an old world culture here, and they may have simulated with Native Americans possibly too, because there's just so many of these sites.
And yeah.
It really gets into that going, I think the Native Americans are the big part of this.
Yeah.
That's but maybe, you know, there's a Bronze Age going on in the old world, and they say they came to the Great Lakes to bring copper back, is one of the theories, Barry Fell and everybody. But when the Iron Age came about, that low grade, you know, you can find iron pretty much in bogs. You can get really, copper is kind of expensive because there's not copper mines everywhere. So you have to travel to get that and get tin, and then you mix them, you make bronze. Mm-hmm. Tin from Cornwall, England, for instance, you might bring that back. That's, you know, it's going to cost money to do that, even though. Or copper. Some of it was in Cyprus, I think, and I think that word means copper. But there are other copper places too. But if they're bringing back this pure copper that's up near the Great Lakes area, Isle Royale in Lake Superior, and that part of that, I think they call it float copper, and it's like 99% pure or something, it runs over to Michigan. And it actually goes underneath the water, like almost like a banana shape. So it's in Michigan too, that same copper.
Interesting.
Scott Walters can really get into that kind of thing. But they found a Greek ship with some of this on it over in the, so like it did, and they can identify its source because of the purity of the copper.
Yeah.
Well, if the Iron Age came along and that replaced a bronze, because it, again, you have to have a high enough temperature with iron, higher than copper and tin, to melt it or whatever. Once they were able to do that, then anybody, even the people with less money, the poor cultures, if you will, in Europe, could actually make iron implements. They could give up on bronze. And so the Bronze Age kind of, I'm sure people still wanted bronze, but it really kind of collapsed a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And if they were coming way across the ocean, they might have said, we don't need to head over there to get, you know, copper anymore. We got iron over here, and we can make our own implements and weapons and stuff like that. Could that have triggered that economy to kind of fall? And then, I mean, it's just a thought, you know?
Yeah.
Because this site, it looks like it was still under development. And 34 of these stones, you know, various sizes all over the hill, and we keep finding more of them. I wouldn't be surprised if, you know, next year I find another one out there, if somebody does, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And they're kind of hiding, you know? I mean, some of them, you have brush and stuff covering the rock, you look at it, And some of these stones aren't out that far. Sometimes they're underneath further, so you have to really get underneath and see if it's been propped.
Yeah.
And this one here is clean today because they excavated it 41 years ago. If you had been here in the 80s, this little road here was there, but it was like a path you could walk on.
Yep.
This is kind of remote. It was all very thick woods out here.
Oh, off the beaten path.
Off the beaten path, very much so, yeah. And you come out here and there's brush, you know, I mean, it was more like, you know, and there are a few stones over here, I think, that also are propped over here. We've got to take a look at them. We may have more than 34. There's one beautiful one like this, and I haven't been able to get underneath it, you know, because it's dirt. You'd have to actually remove some of the dirt
to
see if it's actually propped up. I just don't like to disturb. There's a thing we've been doing here too, OSL dating, optically stimulated luminescence. It's a light test on rock or sediment. And we did four of them here in 2020. We got the results back 2 years later. We did the roof of the oracle chamber, took two rocks from inside the oracle chamber. They did not test. And same thing in Gunjiwamp, two rock samples didn't test another. They're having some problems. But the dirt test actually worked, and the roof dirt on top of the oracle chamber hadn't seen the light of day since 1550 AD.
Whoa.
So that's before the colonial, and that's before, you know, Plymouth Plantation.
Yeah.
Then the end of the Serpent Tail by the Watch House, they did a core there of dirt, and that came back 1400 AD. So that wall wasn't built by some farmer 200 or 300 or even 400 years ago. We have to go back over 600 years to when that dirt last saw the, and it was at the wall, the dirt. And so the wall was sitting there, and then the dirt builds up very slowly, covering up things, windblown particles, vegetation decay, about an inch every 125 years is the average of New England. But when you have, that's kind of on a flat spot. If you have hills and stuff like that, it takes longer because of erosion. That's going on too, that same process. So we still have bedrock exposed from the time of the glaciers. In some areas we have dirt this deep just because the dirt settled down into an area, you know. But in front of that wall, after 2,550 feet, the body of that serpent starts to watch how it undulates. You can see the wall behind it.
Oh, yeah.
Clockwise, touches every astronomical foresight, the stone's
pockets.
Comes back in front of right a beautiful hump, which we always noticed. Like, why is that wall like that shape? But we never noticed the end of it. There's a 90-degree turn into a perfect pointed tail. And at the end of the tail is another rock. It looks, it could represent rattle, because you see some of these with the tail, but then there's a stone beyond it like a rattle. And that can be in Connecticut, but here we have that. And you stand on that stone. I found out this year, you can actually watch the full illumination inside the chamber where there's a quartzite stone being illuminated at 7:30. The stone has a shape kind of like this, and the top of it's like this. At 7:30, the light and shadow, because of the entrance, actually frames it like that, shadow and light. At 8 o'clock, it frames the top of the stone, and at 8:30, it looks like a hand with a finger pointing back at what we think is a fertilization of this egg, with the chamber being the womb, that stone in the back being the egg, and the sun, the rays, and it's the equinox, spring kind of thing, and the sunlight hitting it. That same day, two caves in Colorado, Pathfinder and Creek Crack Cave, which I haven't been, I've been to Colorado many times, never been there, but in California, Mojave North is a similar cave. All natural, but they actually modified them, and in the back is petroglyphs, man-made petroglyphs, and then these is serpent. And in the morning we watch our illumination, it's the head of a serpent with a womb next to it, with a rock inside the womb, which is the egg, we think. You can go out west and you can see a serpent actually split in half by shadow and light at those three caves.
Oh, wow.
But you go to Chaco, which we've been to, on the Butte, but we couldn't get up there. It's restricted. But the sun dagger, but on the equinox, so the sun dagger is one through nine spirals, half the lunar cycle of 18.61 years. Going through it, this bright dagger found in 1977 by a woman, and I always forget her name, but give her credit that she saw that. But there are two daggers on the winter solstice, but on the equinox, it's a different illumination on a serpent, again, split in half by shadow and light. Both California, New Mexico, two in Colorado. You go to Chichen Itza down in Mexico, which we've been to back in the 80s when you could still climb El Callisto, the castle. But in 91 steps that morning, Kukulcan's going down the 91 days, going down 91 steps. And it's a shadow and light illumination. So if you can Facebook Live those, although there are different time zones, it would still be pretty cool because we have ours first here. The biggest serpent effigy I think we know of anywhere in the world possibly is at this site, because it's 25, we GPS'd it, it's 2,550 feet.
Wow.
It wraps around 15 acres. It might represent protecting the sacred land, which is where the site is. And
is that actually on the map?
Yeah, it's on my, it's kind of on the map, it's on the map, and it's also on my diorama that down in the building when you first come in, you see that big model? Well, I built that in 1977 in college, but we updated it. Basically, the watch house, and then it doesn't show the undulations here, it goes up, and then it touches every one of the astronomical alignments.
Oh, yeah.
It comes around,
It comes back, but right in here is actually, we're gonna put the ground penetration radar. The lady's been coming up from Waltham, Mass.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks like the wall came across, ends up with a hump about right there, and then a 90 degree tail, which it doesn't, we should probably change this, but there's a beautiful 90 degree right in front of the boulder. It looks like it, ouroboros, sometimes the tail's in the mouth, most of it. I have seen probably like 20% of them are like, or even less, are like that. Usually like this with the ouroboros.
Yep.
But even Native American pottery seems to show that, but it's Egyptian, Greek, and other old world cultures. But Native Americans, you see that artwork, mm-hmm. you'll see, well, it looks like an ouroboros to me. Yeah. You know, that's what it looks like. So this might be the sacred land, and the main site's about 1 acre, and that's about 15 or 16 acres. And that's 2,550 feet. And actually, there's a, it doesn't show on this. They should have had it on. I think this is actually updated this year. They forgot to put in a dash line on here, the shortcut here, and on the back. And they did a nice job. And I was here, but, you know, they kind of pushed it, and I didn't get a chance to review it like I wish I had. There's actually stonework that goes right across here, connecting this part to this part here, and then it goes around like this and back. And I want to GPR that because you can see the top of what I think is the original wall. So this site's been repurposed. It's been modified. Stonehenge went in three different stages, 1, 2, 3 ABC, over 1,500 years of putting up and taking down. But that's so true of other sites in the Great Serpent Mound in Ohio. There's a thought today it goes back to 300 BC. It's not just Fort Ancient 1100 AD time period. It might actually have been there before that, and you're getting different dates because it was used over generationally, or it could have been abandoned and people could have come back and kind of repurposed it a little bit. But it might be multicultural, or it could just be descendants of the same group years later, and they might have, you know, touched it up or fixed it a little bit. So the dates go from 1100 AD back to 300 BC, and they're still arguing. And you got archaeologists, and they get very territorial about their ideas. Like, oh no, mine's right. That happens too. They want to see 1000% data. You know, I know they say 100% data, but anyway, we have different 16 different carbon datings on this site. We have two OSL dates that worked, two that didn't work. And we have been doing LIDAR. So this area has been LIDAR'd with a handheld LIDAR by Tom Elmore from Connecticut. He lives in Suffield. He's coming up on October 19th with a group, including two people from Peru that are involved, retired. One of them's retired from the cultural center down there. So he's coming up on the 19th of October. He comes up from Mass, and his friend Jared is coming out from Minneapolis. Jared's been here many times. They're working on a project in Belize, in Mayan ruins, a 7,000 acre area. And I got them in contact with each other. So Tom has this $50,000 LIDAR. It can see down to 1 centimeter.
Wow.
16 lasers, goes out 80 meters, has a high definition camera on top. He bought it about 5 years ago. It's still pretty good, even though technology changes quick, it's still good. The software is the big thing, keeping the software, and it's very expensive. That's software is made in Montreal. I think that's where he's still getting it. The hardware was made in Florida. He bought a supercomputer, and this 15 acres that he did with his LIDAR, he had to come up here several times from Connecticut to do this. Well, it took 600 hours of process, just 15 acres of land. I think he did about 16, actually.
That's so amazing.
And then his friend with a ground penetration radar from Waltham, Mass., came up with him several times, and she wants to come back to map all the underground drains here for the first time ever. These are all man-made drains, keep the site, the main site dry. Some of them run 75 feet, and they've never been adequately, mapped. And this will actually see inside of them too, because a couple have been excavated, hammer stones come out, some modern stuff comes out of these, just because like your home, things go into your sink.
Mm-hmm.
These are kind of like drains, and you'll find all sorts of stuff. But she wants to map that. I'm going to have her do that right there. I'm going to have her do the tail where the OSL date came from, because my contention is that wall's sitting on bedrock, just like the rest. Everything here sits on bedrock, all the chambers, walls. The dirt is built up next to them. And the gentleman from Washington State who actually led this whole OSL thing here, Dr. Feathers, he's getting ready to retire. He's been doing it since the 80s. He says, well, the dirt got covered over by the rocks. I'm like, no, the wall was there, and then the dirt came along and it sifted in between the rocks. When you build a wall, you have all the holes there.
Yeah.
The rock. They don't fit together. You know, it's not like, they're not 90 degree blocks tight. They're all different shapes, and there's like, that's where he got the core. So this 1400 year old date isn't when they built the wall. He kind of says, well, it was built 1400. They put the rocks on top of the dirt. The rocks are sitting on bedrock. The dirt came into the holes later.
Yeah.
So, you know, he said, well, the oracle chamber, of course, you couldn't build the chamber underneath the dirt. You had to have the structure build up, the roof slabs put on top, and then the dirt came in. So the chamber precedes the 1550 AD date. But when he gets down here, he goes, well, 1400. I'm like, no, that well could have been sitting there for eons before that.
Yeah.
So all we have is minimum dates from those two or so. They did, I think, some sites, the Gungeewomp site. They did other sites from here to Virginia, 22 sites. It's $1,000 per sample. It takes 2 years to get the results back. They put a little dosimeter in the ground and measured radioactivity for 1 year. So that's, you can't do it any shorter than that.
Mm.
So the University of Washington did all the dates, but he had two physicists from Brookhaven National Laboratory. They were involved with OSL. And their physicists, they're both from Europe, and I got to work with one of them. I think it was the one from France. And they kind of cross over to archaeology. He's a doctor of archaeology. He's been working with this OSL kind of into physics, you know, since the 1980s, so kind of crossover.
Yeah.
We had a two-state archaeologist, we had our archaeologist, we had the LIDAR gentleman, Tom, here that day, and he already mapped this, so he wanted to be here for it. And then we had Doria, and she mapped the roof of the Oracle Chamber where mm-hmm. they took the sample from. So we have LIDAR of that, and then we have beneath the surface where the cores came from. So people go, well, where did you get the, we've done more than a lot of people have. You know, like the LIDAR, we did the ground penetration radar.
Yeah, we noticed the quartz in one of the chambers over there.
The quartz, yeah, that's a big thing here up on the side. A lot of the structures you'll find the quartz. Sometimes we have Carnes in New England, he'll put the quartz piece on top. It could be white quartz, or it could be milky quartz. But the upper well, they're on display in the building. There's a whole collection of them that came out of that well when they cleaned it. My dad actually was the one down in the well on a ladder.
Oh, wow.
With a bucket, a rope, pulling out all the muck, and they found all these quartz crystals at the bottom for the first time in 1963. Yeah. 1961, I'm trying to think who the gentleman was. It might have been, who the heck was it? I'll think of it about a minute. It might have been a very famous guy from Keene State College, I think, was involved with that, Professor Charles Hapgood. And I think he in 61 had somebody helping him doing a little cleaning. My dad had already been involved with the site since 55, so my dad was here. But in 63, my dad said, I'm going to go down and clean that damn thing, and he did. And the bottom of it's wide. We think it's a mine shaft for taking out quartz crystals, is the thought. And we just got more of them back from one of the guides that was here in 63. And he actually brought me back 2 years ago a whole collection of them that my dad must have given them. They're on display down there. And I actually dotted them all with a Sharpie.
Mm-hmm.
And just a little dot so we know which ones he brought back. But he had them for 60 years almost.
Wow.
My dad might have given them to him, I'm sure, because this guy's a very nice guy. And he stayed with us through 68. And then he went off to, he's a guy that actually was opened up the very first alignment. He started with an axe in 65, and he finished up with a neighbor's chainsaw, Dr. Kellett, across the street. They lived over here, and his parents had land in the Buxus.
Mm-hmm.
And he actually cleared out that alignment. And then about 3 years ago, he says, Dennis, I have pictures from 67 of the sunset. I'm like, you do? I said, I thought 1970 with you was the first time, because I was here in 70 with my dad, a neighbor. We drove down from Derry. It was about over a foot of snow on the ground. We met him at his folks' house. He had built a wooden snowmobile. He broke the trail a half mile through the woods. We came up and we saw the sunset. 67, he was up here by himself and he took the first photographs. They're in my book now. And they were through the cirrus clouds, kind of like today, a little bit more. That's kind of a haze up there from the Canadian smoke, I think, above us. More cirrus clouds, and you can see the bright light over the stone setting. But in 70, the clouds parted and there's the sun. You can see the disc or the orb actually setting on the stone in 70.
Oh, wow.
That was the clearest, but I didn't know in 67, but I put those in my book. And my dad knew that. He took them 3 years earlier. He became a nuclear engineer. And when he did that in 1970, he was actually working on the Nimitz. He was putting the two reactors on the Nimitz, which is still out there today floating.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the one with the UFO tic-tac off of San Diego.
Yep.
David Fravor. And David Fravor actually is from Ohio, lived in San Diego. He's a Top Gun kind of guy.
Yep.
And I flew, so I kind of appreciate it. I mean, a lot of people do, I'm sure, but I'd love to meet him. He lives in Windham, New Hampshire, right near one of our chambers, about 6 miles from here.
David
Fravor. He's in New Hampshire right now. So if you see him on TV, he was in the front of the Congress testifying with the other AF-18 pilot, Super Hornet pilot. I forget the guy's name, but he saw his Tic Tac in 2004 with his wingman, and her name was Alexa, I think, Dietrich. And she was in blue face for a while. Now she's retired. She came out and spoke too. So two Top Gun people, and they, you know, skeptics aside, you know,
yeah.
These guys, and I mean, I flew for 30,000 hours. I kind of know what an airplane looks like versus something that's not an airplane or a helicopter or any other type of aircraft. But but David lives right down the street. Well, and this guy that I mentioned that put the reactors on, he ended up going throughout like South. He lived all over the world basically in the nuclear industry. Met his wife he has now in France, working for the French on the nuclear. And then he ended up in Osaka, Japan, about a dozen years ago, He was finishing up his career for Westinghouse, and he was going to go back to Charlotte and finish up and then retire. And Fukushima went off, and he was one of the five people on that team, and he was the last one on that team actually working. They moved him to Tokyo to work on Fukushima. They didn't move him to Fukushima.
I know it's a lot of significance with nuclear reactors or something nuclear with UFOs.
Well, that's true, too. Yeah, you get some of the sites like up in South Dakota and those famous ones where they shut down some of the warheads and everything. Or nuclear plants, you know, that kind of thing. But that's kind of a cool, that's one of our, he's actually kind of like a rocket scientist, a nuclear engineer. And he lives in Maine in the summer, and he lives in France with his wife in the winter. And he's going to be up to join us.
There's some quartz in there.
Yeah, there's mica, and there might be some quartz in there, Try to put it back where it came from, but anyway, Warren is his name, and he's really cool. But his son lives right up the street here. His daughter lives pretty close by. He divorced his 1969 wife that we went to the wedding on. So he's actually kind of back into the interest in this thing. So he's the guy that really opened up the first alignment, saw the very first sunset, and then we saw with him 3 years, at least my first sunset with him, and he was working at that time down in Newport News, Virginia on the Nimitz.
Oh, okay.
And he had driven up that winter in his bug-eyed Triumph, 1958. I don't know how warm that thing was because it's convertible, he had that for quite a while, too, but he actually built, when he was a kid, a pad wheel boat on a big island pond out here. And he built a wooden snowmobile out of parts. And that's the thing that he broke our trails with. So very, very talented guy. And he was one in my dad's 1977 book is when the first time they really mentioned Warren and the work he did on the site during the early astronomical research.
Yep.
And the research actually was triggered by Gerald Hopkins of the Harvard-Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics in Cambridge, Mass. And he's from England. And he wrote Stonehenge Decoded, and he did a paper in 63, but the book came out in 65. We used to carry it here. So because of that book, talking about Stonehenge being a computer and aligned with the sun and possibly moon, you know, that kind of thing, that triggered a CBS special called The Mysteries of Stonehenge in 65, that same year. And when my dad saw it, some of the members of NERA, they had been organized for 1 year at that time, and other members that had been involved with us for years, saw that. They said, we know that these stones are out here. Goodwin was aware of that. Some of the stones are like monoliths, several feet high. Some are falling over. And I wonder if these things might be something astronomical. So that's when Warren began clearing out the winter solstice sunset. He had cleared 800 feet of trees.
Oh.
Yeah, and he did some of it by hand with an axe, and then he got a gentleman across the street, Dr. Kellett, got his chainsaw and came up and made it a little bit quicker, and he had some other people helping him. But so that kind of brings it back in full circle.
Yeah.
And Warren's still alive today, and he's the guy that was here as a guide from 63 up to 68, and then he went off into college and the nuclear industry and all of that stuff. So that's pretty cool, and he'll be down. I think he's going to come down in October to visit us. He just went up to the Arctic Circle. He's still a very kind of one of these guys that goes out and does all this cool stuff, like that.
Yeah.
And he's in his probably 77 or something like that. And he was just up at the Arctic Circle doing Facebook stuff up there.
Oh, wow.
He fly way up in Canada to do that. But yeah, I think his interest has been relit on this site. And he goes, I played up here as a kid, on the site. And I never saw serpentine walls or windows. I said, don't feel bad, Warren. I've been here my whole life, And I said, this just came to light in 2016, and we're still finding them. In fact, I was working by one wall for several days cleaning out some of the firewood left behind from a forestry thing we did. And when I had it almost cleaned up, all the debris, because they left some debris behind, I mean, use it for firewood, I said, I've been there all week. I didn't notice it, but just when I was just about done, I noticed there are four windows in the wall. That's one of our four window walls. And I said, also with the serpentine things, I said, we're still finding them. And yet we've been by these walls a thousand times or more, since I've been a kid back in
the day. So God knows what else is in here.
Who knows? I mean, like I say, we just found with that film producer from Kansas City, we found another one the day he was here and a window when he was here. It's like, what the heck, How come we're not seeing these things years ago?
Mm.
I will say if LIDAR had been used and it wasn't around in the 60s, I think we would have, or 50s, we would have discovered a lot more earlier. Because once you see LIDAR, it's so amazing. You put it on your computer, you can blow it up, you can shrink it down, but you can see the shapes. You can see the serpentine shapes. And even these stones here would have been probably detected much, much earlier in time, Because on LIDAR, you can actually push a button and get rid of all the vegetation. You can wipe it out.
Oh, wow.
Which is kind of cool,
That's amazing.
Which is pretty amazing. And then you can bring the site, you can go below it on LIDAR, you can go above it, you can go into space, look down. It's like When I first saw the LiDAR, I know Tom walked around with it on his back. We have pictures of him down in the building, right on the walls in our visitor center. Tom's there and Doria's there with their radar and all of that. I said, gosh, you didn't use a drone, and he hasn't. And he goes, no, that's what the computer can do. And I'm walking around with that. We can go out and look back from space at this place.
Yeah.
Or you can go down to the ground level with it, and then you can go down to a centimeter and maybe even look at a penny. It's amazing what you can do with it, but it can see down to about 1 centimeter. So you probably see a penny. You might not be able to make out the year and, you know, all the lettering on it.
It's amazing.
Which is pretty amazing, yeah. So I think there's still more discoveries to be made here. I would assume we're going to find more windows, perhaps another serpent wall or two or three. We just don't know. We're probably going to find more of these quarried slabs. Again, that they're not just pieces of stone in the woods, but they've actually been removed from the bedrock. They worked the fissure crack. They separated it. This rock is foliated. It does come up in layers. So if I sent you out today to look for good areas where you could actually split bedrock, you go, what are you, crazy? There's vegetation, there's trees, there's dirt. I can't see all the bedrock. I can see outcroppings here and there.
Yep.
But why would you do that to me, Dennis? But if you were here thousands of years ago and this hilltop is more bare, you would see the bedrock, and you could work, go out there and say, I think we're gonna work this area because I can see it's cracked. We can get wedges in here. We can, you know, it's either been cracked by trees or by other natural causes. But I think we can get in here and separate this stone, and, you know, Dennis will have his slab, you know. So the other thing too is when you're moving these, you don't want to move these multi-ton stones over dirt, and you got trees blocking you, and you got roots, and you got stuff in the way. If you had been here thousands of years ago, these trees wouldn't have been here. You'd have mostly bedrock.
Yeah.
And I can't think of a better thing is to find some trees. There would have been some trees here. You'd cut them down, and then you use the logs for rollers.
Yeah.
Bedrock, and then rock on top of that, and it's a better surface to move things on.
Yeah, more smoother.
A lot smoother. It's very firm, right? The only time this soil gets firm is maybe in the wintertime when it freezes, and that might be okay too, you know. But I prefer to move something this heavy on log rollers on bedrock that's not going to give, you know, and just get bogged down in the dirt and stuck, you know. So ground penetration radar is very useful today because you can map all this stuff and you can see it. You know, it's like X-ray vision, you know, Superman's vision. But these people didn't have to contend with all this dirt back then. You know, they had some dirt.
So basically, this is almost all open at one point.
Yeah, and that Pat Hume, our archaeologist, started in '89 when she was president of the New Hampshire Archaeological Society, and she stayed with us up to about 2 years ago when she retired. She's in her 80s now. She was just here this spring visiting. She lives in Florida near her daughter in a retirement home, and she came back because she loves this place. But she was mainstream. It took a little bit of to get her down here because most of the archaeologists in the Northeast are either colonial, post-colonial. If they're pre-colonial, they're looking for pottery and points in the ground. They're not looking for chambers, standing stones, slabs.
Yeah.
This is not in their vocabulary. You know, they're not trained on this. These are all artifacts, you know. But so she joined us. But by 1991, she was done with the North Stone. They were digging the North Stone. They found a fire pit in front of the North Stone. The dating on the material was 1,300 years old. So somebody at 1,300 years ago built a fire in front of the stone, used it as a backstop. The stone could have been there for eons before that, but somebody was using that as a backstop. And when they excavated, they found all the soil undisturbed, the layers, the different stratigraphy. And when they got down, they found the fire pit. They charcoaled, they did a carbon dating on it, and it came out to about 1,300 years old, you know, roughly around 700 AD. Somebody was using that stone. After that project was done, they actually started doing a shovel test pit, STP study across the hilltop, 50 centimeter square. And they go down to the hit bedrock, or what they call a preoccupational level, where no human activity, they assume, took place below that. Although it may be a mistake too. They're starting to find older and older stuff in America, going back 100, you know, people being here much earlier. But if you go down too far here, you're going to hit bedrock, you know. It's pretty, in fact, this thing is sitting on bedrock today. Even that rock is sitting right on bedrock down there. So she started mapping the hilltop, and her husband was still alive at the time, the doctor of geology, so he was a great asset. And what she said is maybe 75% of the hilltop is bare bedrock, brush and stuff like that. But it would have been a pretty open hill. And that's nice for looking at the alignments with the solar, you know, or lunar alignments. You don't have the trees in the way. Warren, that started clearing that alignment in 1965, wouldn't have had have done that thousands of years ago. I'd imagine they had to take a few trees down that would have been in their way, you know. And they could have used them for log rollers. They could have used them for building fires, you know. And if there's any wooden superstructures, they could have used the wood for that. But we don't think they lived on the hill. We think they lived on either the lower parts of the hill, on the sides, because we think the hilltop itself is more of a sacred area. Mm-hmm. It's up high, nearer to the heavens, if you will. Yep. And most megalithic sites in Europe, and there are about 50,000 as a comparison, are tombs, temples, and monuments, from our best understanding. They were not usually homes. Scarabray in the Orkneys was a home.
So basically these sacred places be on high altitude?
Yeah, or? Up high. And yeah. Even pyramids were built as platforms for temple sites at some sites. Even in the United States, some of the Million Mounds that were built, a lot of them were flat top, ridge top, and they had wooden structures on top that either the priest stayed in or they did ceremonies mm-hmm. on. The conical shaped ones generally were thought to be, from the evidence, or burial mounds, most of the conical ones, kind of that kind of shape. But then you have the effigy shape, like, some are shaped like, looks like a crocodile out in Newark, although it looks like a salamander. We didn't get to that when we were very close to it. But some are shaped like serpents, as we mentioned, and some are actually shaped like bears in Wisconsin. These are huge too, you know, or eagles. We went to Poverty Point, Louisiana, and it's over 600 by 700 feet, and I think it was a bird effigy, right next to all the concentric rings, mm-hmm. which they're kind of hard to see today, except out in the woods you can see some of them. But that was an amazing site that goes back, I think, as early as 4,600 years old. You know, it's pretty old. So they built one shaped like animals. They built others that are geometrically shaped, like the Newark Mounds, the Great Circle. They have square, and sometimes they octagonal shape, too. And they're in Chillicothe too, you know. And then there was a road built between them that was 200 feet wide. It was curved, and it connected them 65 miles distance. And we drove along that. I never saw the road, you know, but satellite and archaeological research show that this thing was 200 feet. You know, I mean, unless you have 18 wheels, why would you build something that big? But I think it's a sacred way, and they put a lot of effort in. 65 miles, they curved it on the sides. It's like, wow, you know.
Yeah.
A lot of it's wiped out because of agriculture, plowing. Took down a lot of the monuments, you know, the earthen monuments, but the sacred way too. I guess it was satellite imaging and aerial, probably drone and LIDAR work can pick it out among where they plowed it for years and years. Over 150 years they've been plowing it, you know.
It's interesting.
But yeah, I think they're ceremonial. I think they lived in hide, wood, or bark homes, and those are perishable. We think they're, and that's what our archaeologist Pat, the one I mentioned, Pat, she was looking for a habitat site on the lower parts of the hill, and it was never complete. You know, I'm sure she wishes she could go on for decades, because, you know, that kind of, and at the end of her time here, that's what we were looking for, habitat sites. Because in the early 90s, during one of the shovel tests, but she found, I believe it's rhyolite. It's a material from just north of Boston, and it can identify its source. So it was imported to this hill. They're making tools. Because we have a workshop for making tools, you probably have a habitat site very close by there. She never opened it up. She, you know, the area around that.
Yeah.
She was always wanting to open that area up. She found what appears to be an underground turtle effigy.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and had two pulse moles, which is man-made, where pulse once stood. This rock work that looks like an effigy of a turtle so far. And she showed it to one of her husband's students, who was a student of her husband's, I should say, back probably in the 80s and 90s. Now, he's been a doctor of geology for decades. But he came up with a Tufts University man in our driveway, came up, we met him. He went up with her and our assistant archaeologist, and he looked at that particular thing, goes, well, that's a man-made feature. It's not natural. You know, he confirmed that. And then he looked at a couple other things we had here, too. So it was nice to have a stamp on it that, geologically speaking, it's not a natural formation. It's back man-made. That has over, even today, I mean, she might be in Florida thinking about that, because she's trying to find somebody in New England that would be interested in continuing her research here. Yeah. It's very difficult, because then if it's old stuff, they're looking at pottery points, maybe a burial, maybe a workshop, but this thing, and the site itself, but this thing looks like a turtle underneath the ground that's been covered over by years.
That's interesting,
years.
Yeah.
Pretty cool. Yeah, I mean, when you look at it, it's like, wow, and then you can see very vividly the two, I don't know, maybe for me to you is the width of it.
Yep.
To near a glacial boulder that's split. It's pretty cool. I'm hoping if we can get James, our manager now, did do a 2-week workshop up in northern New Hampshire, right at the top of New Hampshire near in Errol. And I've been up there many times, but they have a site that dated back as early as 8,000 years. And now he has more contacts with her old group, New Hampshire Archaeological Society. My dad was a member of that too. So he's got some contacts there, and I'm going to see if we can, because they just don't know about stonework, other than tools, little stuff, you know, not great big chambers and stuff, you know. If we can get them in here and break the ice with them, maybe they can get interested. And this site here is, like all the others that might be of similar construction, they're precious, you know, and they're part of our ancient past. David Stuart Smith, before he passed it, you know, it's like an ancient culture of stone builders or a lithic culture or a stone building culture across the Northeast that's been kind of unrecognized, ignored, in some cases ridiculed by mainstream, saying, oh, they're nothing but a bunch of crazy farmers' works. And some of these are no longer around because of that attitude. People said, well, then in that case, we're just going to bulldoze them and build over them. And that's the legacy that some of these archaeologists are going to have when they're gone, is they dismiss this stuff, you know. They didn't take it seriously. They weren't interested. That's slowly changing. But and it's really sad they had that attitude. Well, if they say it, nothing, then let's just bulldoze it. We'll put a home up, put a road through it, whatever. Well, what some people have done, though, like the Danville Chamber in Danville, about 8 miles from here, is the builder actually built all over southern New Hampshire homes. And when he got there, he bought the property and developed it. He kept the chamber intact and gave it to the town of Danville. It was a win-win. He got the build, and they got a chamber that's now part of the town history. And you can actually visit it today. It has a plaque on it, similar to America Stonehenge. Mm. Kind of cool. And that's a win-win, you know? Like, that's, he gets the build. It's, you know, it's important. He's got a lot of money tied up, and he has a lot of people working for him. And the other, and people need homes, I guess, you know?
Yeah.
And on the other hand, he didn't go and bulldoze. He could have put another house lot in there probably, and it would be gone today, but he didn't do that. He gave it to the town. So that was a really nice gesture, and I'm sure the town, you know, was good to him too, working with him, you know. It's a, you know, a positive thing, I think.
Yeah.
That kind of thing should happen all over the place. You know?
Mm-hmm. But, I went by a sign that said a sacrificial table.
Yeah.
Where's that at?
Yeah, you're going to go back on the main site. It'll be back. I'll point you out. You're going to get back into where the chain link fence is.
Yep.
And that chain link fence, by the way, was put up by Mr. Goodwin in 1937. I actually have the paper to the company that actually signed the contract to put that up. And it turns out that the people who put it up, one of their relatives was James Whittle, who joined us in the 1960s.
Oh, wow.
James was one of our archaeologists. He died of cancer in 1999, but he was very instrumental here in the first carbon datings, you know, and the director of research in the 60s here. And then he started his own group away from NERA called the Early Sites Research Society, I believe the name of it was, in the 1970s, I think. But he kind of remained in contact with us. So last time I saw him, it was at a NERA meeting in 1999 when he was sick with cancer, you know.
Mm.
So that fence was put up in 1937, so it's been there.
Is that with the chains over there too?
The little plastic chains, I put some of those up in 1990 when I got the pictures. I couldn't believe I put them up 30-something years ago. I'm like, it feels like only 2 decades. But the green chain link fence is part of the history of the site now. It was put up before World War II, and it's remarkable that these people could make a chain link fence in the 1930s that's still with us today in perfect shape.
Yeah.
You can be, you know, it's quality, you know.
And that's, yeah, they don't have quality anymore.
Yeah, I know, you know, yeah. They're not as heavy duty. This fence is rugged, you know, and galvanized and everything. They did a nice job on it back then. Built to last. But what Goodwin did is he put the chain link fence, he put barbed wire up, and he aimed the barbed wire in to keep people from stealing artifacts. That's why the barbed wire on top is aimed in. Usually it's out. And so he did that deliberately, I believe, to keep people from stealing artifacts during the 1930s and 40s, whatever. Yeah.
And the table, is that lettered or numbered?
Yeah, so that'd be the sacrificial table. You want to go up there. It's called the groove table. It's number 31. Right
31?
There. Yeah, you'll see it on the main site. It's right inside. It's right near the wooden platform. It's right there. You're going to 74. I was here when we put that platform up. The table's just a little bit south of that. The table's right in this area right here. And you can't miss it. Right near the oracle chamber. Do you get in the oracle chamber?
Yeah.
The underground chamber?
Yep.
So it's connected by the oracle tube, you know. Kind of like a Wizard of Oz, you know. There's a 6-foot tube. You stand down. In the oracle chamber, and there's a step, and you stand on the step, and I'm almost 5'7", roughly 5'7", so anywhere on that height, you can stand there and speak, and you're at the right level that the voice goes through, comes out under the table, making a sound like a voice coming under the table, maybe like a god or spirit, or, you know, some sort of, maybe somebody that was like a priest or shaman, you know, spoke, like the oracles in Delphi. We went to Delphi, Greece, back in the 80s, and they say that this site is built on a fault line, by the way, an earthquake fault line, and Delphi is. And they say at that time, thousands of years ago, the gases came up, and the priestess would be affected by the gases. It had an effect, and she would give prophecies.
Mm.
When we went there, we didn't see that, so it must have stopped.
You know? Yeah.
But Peru, Machu Picchu is built on a fault line, and about 700 of the stone circles going from Wales into England. They're also in Scotland, too, and I don't know if these all, we've been up to Scotland, but I don't know. They're all built on or next to a fault line, an earth, you know, a geological fault line. And when earthquakes happen, some people suggest that light illumination from piezoelectric effect was given off. And maybe they thought that was special. At least in Peru, they might have thought it was special too, but they also used the crack in the rock to extract material. And that's what they did here too. One of the biggest roof slabs, 14 tons, was right up against, one edge of it is actually the fault. Perfectly made straight line. It goes right across the entire hilltop to the glacial cliff shelter, 1,000 feet that way. I found the fault over there too. The whole hill is split in half, east to west. The site is bisected. It's split right down the middle with this fault. It's part of the Clinton-Newbury fault line that starts in Newbury, Mass, goes down to Clinton, Mass, and actually ends up going down towards North Stony Point, my best understanding.
That's interesting.
Yeah, so the earthquake fault lines might be of importance to ancient people. It's practical because we have a crack like that. You can actually work the rock and get one edge is nice and straight. But also, maybe it was something more than that. Maybe they thought that these earthquakes, you get these glows or orbs, you know, kind of glowing. I don't know. I haven't seen any of that myself, but people have, you know, reported that. So that's interesting. The earthquake fault line, there's a picture of that in my book, too. The first books on the site came out with Goodwin, 46, called The Ruins of Great Ireland and New England. It was at time when he was very sick, and he died in 1950. He was already sick in the late 40s. So Malcolm Pearson, who he gave the site to when he died in 1950, is when my dad worked with him. Malcolm only died about 2011, at 100 years old. And then until 1970, his family still owned the Upton site in Upton, Mass, which is open to the public too. You can actually go down and visit them. It's an amazing structure. In 65, my dad finally bought the site from Malcolm. He leased it from 58 to 65. So back in 65, Goodwin had this site because Goodwin gave him it, 20 acres. And his family owned the Upton Chamber. So his family owned two different sites for these chambers, you know. So the Malcolm Pearson was a big part of the site. And because my dad first came here in 1955 because of a WBZ radio show called Yankee Ons. It was on WBZ in Boston, one of the biggest stations still today. And it was syndicated on some other stations too around New England. And Alton Hall Blackington had a show called Yankee Yarns. And later he was on WBZ, like I say, the radio show, but he also was on WBZ-TV by the mid-50s. He had a TV show. In the 1940s, I'm all set, thank you very much. But in the 1940s, he actually did a show on us in 1949. I have the letterhead, and he wrote to Goodwin, but Goodwin couldn't respond because he was already sick, you know? So it went to a guy that was taking care of the place, I believe. I think it was Harry Abbotson. He was a local that helped. He had the key to this fence up here, padlocks on it. And Goodwin lived in Hartford at the time, and Malcolm Pearson was down in Sutton, Mass. So back then, no interstate highway system back in those days. So in 1949, he writes to Harry S. says, I understand why Goodwin didn't get back to me. You know, he was sick, you know.
Yeah.
He goes, I did a show on your site. He goes, I want to do another show. But the people are so interested in the first show, they want to know if they can visit this place. Can people visit this place? It was not open to the public. So I don't see what the response was. But 1955, 6 years later, in the summer, my dad, on a Friday night, 7:30, he's listening to WBZ radio. They had a lot of talk shows back then, and I guess they do today. But anyway, it was his show. And on that show that evening, it was all about the site. My dad goes, what the heck? He only seven or eight miles from here he lived. He never heard of it.
Well,
a couple days later, he was at a barbershop, Warren Haywood in Derry, where I used to get mine when I was a kid. And Warren actually raced horses at the Rockingham Racetrack. It was very famous, you know. Seabiscuit raced there. I think Warren Admiral might have raced there. But anyway, he used to race horses there, but he was a barber. And my dad's waiting to have his hair cut, looking at a magazine and waiting, you know. And he's, oh, my God, this is the thing I heard on the radio just a few days before that. Oh, hell of a coincidence. And it's pictures for the first time my dad could see what the site looked like. And that was by a gentleman. I'm trying to think of the gentleman's name. But he wrote the story in 1952. So when my dad, looking at it, goes to Warren, hey, can I borrow this magazine? I want to show the family. He goes, well, how old is it? He goes, well, it's 3 years old, 1952. He goes, Dad, you can have the magazine. So my dad was pretty happy. He took it home. And that weekend at my aunt and uncle's up in the same town of Derry, you know, 7 or 8 miles from here, they're playing cards with about 10 people. And I was 18 months old. And I remember going out to, my aunt and uncle had, it was at their house. Their son is 6 months older than me, so we probably were playing together, you know, on the floor or whatever. Everybody's there, you know, having beer, playing cards. And my dad put the magazine out, and nobody recognized it until it went to my mom's sister and her husband. And they looked at it and said, oh, yeah, we used to come here in the 1930s.
Oh, wow, I recognize this, you know. And my dad goes, can you find the place? I want to see this. And they're like, well, we haven't been there in 20 years. I don't know. It's not open to the public. There's no road signs. There's no. They didn't have Google Maps, but there was nothing, you know. So that Sunday, the next day, the four of them came down here. I guess they must have stayed with Grandma. My cousin did, too. And they came down, they drove around this area, and they finally found a road that looked familiar. It was an old dirt road in the going up the hill, and they stopped, parked the car at the bottom, walked up, and they were at the right place. They saw the chain link fence, and then my dad climbed under it. They were trespassing. Got inside the site, looking around, and he was gone. The other three stayed outside. They didn't want to climb underneath that, you know. And when he came back out, he was just, like, blown away by the site. And mentioned he'd never seen anything quite like this. It's amazing. And, gee, I'd like to get involved with this somehow. Maybe I could even open it to the public. And my mom goes, you got rocks in your head, basically. He did. And that's how my dad first got encountered that in 19. Yeah. But my aunt and uncle had been here in the 30s. And I have an uncle that he passed away in 2016. And my Uncle Oz, he actually moved to Long Island in 2016 to be close to his oldest daughter. His wife had Alzheimer's. And then he passed away about a year later. They both were on Long Island, but they lived in Derry too, same time. And they was instrumental in the astronomy. He was one of the guys that actually got the astronomy going on the site. He goes, you know, my grandmother, Annie Gage, used to come here in the 1890s and play. Goes back to the 1890s, and I was kind of, this is in 2016, I said, 2015, I said, my God, your grandmother used to play here? I don't think you ever told me that before. So some of our family goes back to the 1890s on this place, you know? So it's kind of a long history with us on the site too, you know. So.
Oh, and also up toward the front, is that where the snake eating its tail is?
Yeah, that's number two. That's the watch house, the very first structure you saw.
All right.
And as you approach that, on the old original walkway and service road, if you didn't take the nature trail, because the nature trail takes you into the woods more, and
yeah.
You open that up around 97. It's kind of cool, but if you go on the old road, you can actually now see the boulder head looking to the south. You can see three undulations in the wall and how the wall continues up and then it comes back. You can see even see the hump in front of its face.
So it's basically when you first come out of the visitor center?
Yeah, when you walk, if you come out of the visitor center, just start walking straight out back instead of the nature trail. You
yep.
will see that whole profile of that.
Oh, circle. All right.
And I have it in
check
my book.
That out.
I had that LIDAR. I took it off the computer and took a picture of the LIDAR that Tom did.
Yep.
And that LIDAR image is so cool. It hits the head. It has the hump in front of its face with the tail where it's biting it. And it has the undulation behind it. The boulder itself is actually a lunar minor standstill moonrise alignment, which will be in 2035. And it was cleared out just 3 years ago. We did a two-year project thinning out the forest.
Yep.
So we can actually watch it this time for the first time, which will be 2035. It's every 18 and a half years
yeah.
for that. and then it is also a February 1st alignment, which is in bulk by the Celts, but it's February 1st. Or second or third. It's actually around Groundhog's Day in Candlemas. It's an ancient Celtic holiday, but it's also Native American. Mesa Verde has it. Well, the first hump actually is Samhain by the Celts. It's November 1st, All Saints Day,
yep.
the day after Halloween. And so there's an astronomical alignment to that whole thing. And you have the illumination going into the chamber itself, which is the equinox sunrise, and it illuminates the egg in the back wall of the stone that looks like an
yeah.
egg. So then we have the stone and bone pendant found in there. We have the couple of bison bones that were found inside the chamber. And that chamber is one of 50 of that style, too, in a way. Even in Gunjewampin Groton, Connecticut, the boulder is on the right side. As you look into the structure, the structure is built around the boulder on the left. There are 50 of that type in New England that we're aware of. And I don't know if that number has been updated to something more.
Are you going that way, though?
I'm going to be doing a little bit of work up here, but it's number two, and I might see you down there.
All right, because I'd love to see that, the serpent.
Definitely. When you go there, and if you walk back from the building, when you go back down to number two, and you
yep.
walk back, you just got to look behind you, turn around and look back, and see the boulder,
yep.
the hump, the pointed tail there is amazing, and that's in the lighter
image. So basically, come out of the building, and you're looking straight.
Yeah, looking out straight up the trail.
Yep.
But when you go backwards, Teddy, you're going to go by the boulder.
Yep.
Look inside of it, see the quartzite stone. By the way, Hans Holzer wrote a book in 1992, long before Columbus. And the one that did the foreword, Barbara Hand Clow, she's kind of famous. I don't know if she's still alive, but she got involved with research. Her name's out there, and kind of probably like Sedona and stuff, I think, but she's kind of known. She actually comments in her foreword. I think she did the foreword in this book. It would have been the foreword, I think. Anyway, I have the book at home. And there she's talking about that quartzite stone back in 1992, going, She says, this stone seems to be important. And because today she'd be like, oh my God, it illuminates. Back then, the trees blocked any possibility of illumination. So when they cleared out with the fiddle bunch, they went right to our neighbor's yard. In fact, they did it once. And when I saw it, I told our licensed forester, Brian. He went to UNH for his degree, and we interviewed several of them in 2018. A couple of them. And we liked him so much, we hired him. And we told him, they can't damage the walls. They can't damage the structures and all of that when they come in here with their equipment during the winter months when everything's frozen. But when they did it, I said, Brian, can you open that up a little bit more? And what they do is they cut the trees and they make a product, whether it's lumber or firewood. So they were kind of happy. I said, we really got to take it to the neighbor's yard because we want the sunlight to come in here. Otherwise, we can't see this. And they did a nice job. And that June of the equinox of 2020 is the first time we ever saw that in our lives. It was open enough. The sunlight came in and illuminated it. And I saw it at 8 o'clock. It was illuminating and shadow like the top of the stone, which is shaped like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then it had a hand. But 2 years ago in 2022, we saw the illumination from the wind platform. That's one. That's earlier in the morning. And then you go down to the oracle chamber. There's another stone with a little cupola on top of the stone. It's like a little dimple. And you can watch the equinox. There's a certain spot. You have to have 2 points to make an alignment. Otherwise, you have nothing. But there is a structure there. One of the walls, you sit there. And that's the equinox, spring and fall. You go to the other side of the chamber, it's winter solstice rising.
Yeah.
You go to the opposite side, the end of another wall, and it's winter. And it could be all coincidental, but it looks like it works. That's all I can tell you. And that stone has that little dimple. Like
they knew what they were doing back then.
Yeah, yeah, and it's a very short back site to fore site, so it's not one of these several hundred feet like we have. But I go up top in the wind platform, and then we take the people down there. And then at 8 o'clock, I was showing them that illumination. But this time, I went down with the lady at 7:30. Because the other two were done, and everybody was going out to have coffee. Some were going back to work. Some were coming back later in the day for the sunset. I'm standing there talking to her, looking at her, and the chamber's behind me, watch house. I said, now, we got 30 minutes. You want to hang here? Because we've got 30 minutes before you see the illumination. I said, what we're going to see is, and I turned around and looked at it, and I went, wait a minute. And I looked back, and what I saw for the first time ever in 2022, 2 years after I saw this and that, I saw the bottom of the stone, which is shaped like that. The top against like that. It's kind of like that kind of. The bottom of the stone was perfectly framed with light and shadow in the bottom. And at 7:30, 30 minutes later, the top of the stone is shaped like that with a shadow light. And at 8:30, 1 hour after it begins, it looks like a hand with an index pointing back at this fertilized egg. Like, the deed is done. Oh my God, I was so excited. I sent it off to Scott and Haley and other people. They're like, oh my God, that is so cool. Because they think it's cool, you know. Scott will come here about every year or so to do his thing. He's working with off camera, but he's working. I think he's on Gaia. Yeah. He's on that right now with a show.
Mm.
I don't get Gaia, but I saw a clip. It looked kind of interesting. A lot of Knights Templar stuff, medieval stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if he's going to branch into some a little bit earlier stuff because we're kind of an earlier time period.
Yeah.
But he's also working with David Schrader, something possible too. It would be a different thing, you know. So, but he comes in about every several months. He was here a year and a half ago doing a Nova Scotia to Washington, D.C. It was a Founding Fathers, Knights Templar, Mason, because a lot of the early Founding Fathers were Masons.
Yep.
And started Nova Scotia and Halifax, and he made his way, did a couple things like the Overton Stone, and then they flew down to Boston, came up, did their thing up here. And that was a year and a half ago. It was like just around the equinox of 2022, that fall. And they were here for 2 days. And then they took off to the Westford Night in Massachusetts, made their way to New York City, saw some of the obelisk and stuff, and then they went to Washington. And they had a group with them, you know, it's one of these group tours. And they invited me to stay with them, but I just couldn't. That would have been cool because they go out to these cool places to eat and they see some cool
different
stuff. Well, then they did the other one in the spring and it was just a 2 day up here. They didn't have like the tour with them, but people came.
Mentioning Masons, that Tower Newport.
Mm-hmm.
If you notice the sidewalks, right? I launched my drone up and it's a square encompass.
Really?
Yeah.
People aware of that?
Because I was noticing the way the sidewalk's curving is a Masonic Lodge at the corner.
Yeah.
So I launched the drone up and I went on Google Earth. When you go on Google Earth, you can see the square encompass.
The square encompass of Masonic Temple.
Yeah.
Scott either knows about that or will know about that too. I don't know. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
My
Indian chief was up there too. We talked about the Wamsetta Stone and the Cumberlandite and the stonework.
Yeah, Scott, mentions those both. Yeah.
Which ties them into it too, you know.
We had Daryl Jameson. He's Black Eagle. He's a branch of the Wampanoag.
Oh, Daryl, I know. It's my buddy.
Oh, he's been here.
Yeah,
twice.
Yep. He was on the Holzer files. He says, I'm 23% Orkney Island blood.
Yep.
He goes to Jameson, and Sir James Gunn was with Sir Henry St. Clair. There are distant relatives that came on that expedition.
I shall tag him on
he
this.
He goes, yeah. That's one of my, you think that, but he said on this site here, he had a very bad reaction to the site.
He's yeah.
A beautiful place. He does say that he doesn't think his Native American side of his blood were involved with the site. He feels it was more of an old world thing, I think, if I got it correct. But it's on the, you can see it on the whole.
Yeah, because I told him I was coming up here. He said, be careful because there's a lot of demonic activity. And,
yeah. I had to say, yeah, that was an interesting reaction. I say most of the people up here and myself over the years have got kind of a more peaceful feeling to the yeah. site. And it's interesting that is what he got. You
yeah.
know? And that's, you know, you kind of respect everybody's kind of opinion, yeah. I guess, in a way. I would say most of it seems peaceful here. There may yeah. be some element that he's latched onto. Maybe the sacrifice.
Yeah.
Because I could never really sacrifice anything.
Yeah.
Just not like that. I wouldn't make a good hunter either, even if I was. I might have to, you know.
Yeah.
Now, if you have to, you have to do what you do. But
yep.
I just never been like.
That's interesting. Yeah, Daryl was a good friend of mine.
Yeah.
Lives in Woonsocket, Rhode Island.
Yeah. Yeah. So Daryl, yeah, he's been here a few times, and because he's on my Facebook too, and he puts out different things. And when Scott puts something up, I see Daryl jumps yeah. in, and like Scott said. So Daryl, yeah, he's always invited back here. I had a great talk because my son was born with a blue spot. The Mongolian spot.
I actually invited him. I think it was a few months ago. I was like planning to come here. He goes, oh, I don't want to go back.
You don't want to go back there. Well, he did his interview halfway between the building and the watch house.
Yeah.
When he did it. He wouldn't go any further than that. And they accommodated him.
Yep.
And it was one. They were here all week filming. I mean, there were people. The makeup artist was from Virginia.
Wow.
The main crew was from California. Scott and David Trader are both from Minneapolis. They know each other. And they came out. Scott came out. He was flown out special for 3 days to be, you know, like 5 minutes of talking, you know. But he filmed them, though, for quite a while. And Haley came out with them. That was pretty cool. And they had other people on there talking, too. You know, they had different people that were on there. I'm trying to think of a couple other people. My wife knows some of the guys. I was on there, too. They filmed me on Monday, and they filmed me on the reveal
yep.
on Friday night. What they showed me was a picture of something in the Oracle Chamber. It looked like a person standing there. And it was Hans Holzer's daughter. She came up, and I actually encouraged them to bring her, because when they were doing the show, she stayed in New York. She's got a bunch of kids. They filmed her at her home, I assume, and she never was on the road with the rest of the group.
Yeah.
With David Schrader and his whole, you know, there was a, what's her name, Cindy Kozin? Koza. She's from New Hampshire. She lives in Colorado. She comes, she goes, and they didn't want to have us communicating, and they didn't want us to contaminate their minds with information, so they were polite but cordial, like, you know. They were nice, and Cindy goes, you know, she didn't want to be me putting stuff in her mind, and that's cool,
right? Yeah,
that's good. But anyway, the little talk we did, she goes, yeah, I'm from Ashland, New Hampshire. She goes, and we go up to the Lakes region, we love it up there. She goes, but I'm living in Colorado, I've never heard of your place, and I come out here to do the show, and I'm like, my God, in my own home state, the site exists. I said, well, that's pretty typical. My dad always said, you know, we're not a well-known place, but that's not our intent. You know, we like people to know about it. And the
yeah.
more, the better, because people become more appreciated of
yep.
it, respectful of it, you know, and hopefully no vandalism and stuff like that of any of these sites.
Yeah.
But David, and then they invited Daryl Jameson to come up. And but a review to me, they show this person standing in the thing, and it was taken with her dad's camera that day. She used her dad's old camera,
mm-hmm.
and this looks like a person in silhouette standing in the Oracle Chamber.
Oh.
And that was pretty freaky in a way, because it really looked like, you know, it was really weird. And then they had voices too, you know. And then Cindy also talks about some of the serpent stuff going on. And I hope I didn't contaminate them, because you want it to be a pure show. Like, I didn't, you know, if I tell you stuff, you're going to probably repeat it, you know, if you don't know about it, but you come up with your own experience.
Yeah.
And that's kind of cool, you know. And I don't think we did, you know. I know David was aware of it, but I don't think Cindy Kozo was aware of it, because I didn't. Her and Shane, the other guy. And but they had people from all over the country. They were here, three producers. One came in on Thursday, met up with us, explained everything. And then he went off and did a couple things for a few days. And the rest flew in on Sunday.
Yeah.
And they were here a Saturday morning, all night.
Wow.
It was pretty cool. You know, Scott's show was filmed here twice, too, because the camera guy actually forgot to back up the camera, and they had to come all the way out from Midi Films is based in his town of Minneapolis, and they had to come out again and spend $60,000 in 2012 because they didn't have the stuff backed up, and they told the guy, don't ever do that again.
Yeah.
You just cost us $60,000
because
of hotels, airfares,
yep.
and everything, and they had to film us twice, you know, for that show. What I'm going to do is a little weed whacking right here.
All
right. I was going back on the main site.
Yeah.
You can go to the main site. You can go see the table. There's a chain around the table. We used to have people back in the 50s and 60s and whatever walking around it, but people were climbing on it, causing damage to it. So we had to put a stop to that, but you're welcome to film it from above. And
all right.
You know what you do is go in that. There's a gray chain link fence. It's a 4-footer.
Yep.
And you go up there and you look right down at it, and you get the best view of that.
Oh, okay, that's where the fence is too, right?
Yeah, the green fence is there. The green fence is the crystal one that goes around the main site. But that fence was put up in 1970. I was here. My Uncle Oz was actually working here at the time. My Uncle Oz is the guy I was mentioning that his grandmother played up here. But Oz was a World War II pilot.
He
got shot down in Belgium in B-17. Flew B-29s, he flew the cargo version, and he flew some fighters too, but not during the war. After the war, he got a chance to fly his fighters.
Yeah.
And that's what inspired me, but he was a friend of Alan Shepard's, the first astronaut, which is cool, you know?
Yeah.
So I always loved flying, you know, because of that. And Uncle Oz actually worked at Raytheon and at Sanders, and he get those government contracts. He got laid off in 74, and my dad put him to work here in the summer into the fall. And then we closed back then in the fall. So he did like ski patrol and some other stuff, and then he got called back to Raytheon, that's where my son's working today, Raytheon on the Patriot. But so my Uncle Oz, very smart guy, you know, and he went to UNH and everything, but he was really instrumental in forming NERA in 1964 with my dad, and he moved back from California, and he was in California working up Point Lagoon rocket sled test and AOR navigation. So after the war, he lived in California, and then he moved back here around 1960 or 61, and he already was aware of the site. In the 50s, he had been out here a little bit too. So he kind of really, you know, he was part of the site too, you know.
Yeah.
And so my Uncle Oz, you know, and but the astronomy was my Uncle Oz, my dad, a couple other people, and that guy that became a nuclear engineer as a kid. He was, you know, doing stuff here, so it's so cool. And your first name again?
Oh, Dan Bugatti.
Dan, I remember that because one of our researchers that worked here in the 70s, he became the president there at Dan.
Oh, nice.
I'll think of Dan.
I wish I had a card on me. If I wanted my car, I'll give it to you before I leave.
Yeah, and I would be happy to be interviewed by you.
Nice.
I enjoy that very much. We're going to try to go up to Prince Edward Island, Canada. We were up in Newfoundland last year and we saw the Viking settlement.
Oh, yeah.
First time. And the year before that, 2 years ago, we went up to Iceland and I got to see where the Vikings were up there. And that was kind of cool. We've been to Ireland and stuff, you know, but I haven't been to Scandinavia, but we did do Iceland, and I fell in love with Iceland. I just, it's so far north, but it's actually really beautiful up there. I don't know if you've been up there. It's just, you know, it's just, I got to go back. You know? Very nice, and they've been very nice to us.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, I think I'm doing New Zealand because New Zealand, by the way, I did a radio show out of New Zealand about 10 years ago. In the middle of the night, I did a whole radio show with this gentleman, and he never mentioned it at the time, but they have megalithic sites there too. So that's on my bucket list to go to New Zealand. But Australia, a few years ago, that came out that this is the Aussie Stonehenge, and you can Google that too, and it's pretty cool. It's all this stonework. We've had people from Australia. They say, no, I don't know about it. But a few people said, oh, I know where that is. My daughter lives right near that complex. It's a megalithic site in Australia. But New Zealand's the most recent one. But yeah, I went up to Newfoundland last year. And I got to, my dad was in the Coast Guard before he worked at AT&T Bell Labs as an engineer for 30 years. He was in the Coast Guard in the early 50s. And he actually was based in Labrador, right across from Newfoundland. And he was working at the Loran Station, long-range navigation for marine and for airplanes. So he got a lot of electronic engineering skills in the Coast Guard. He went to the academy and everything, and then he got a job with AT&T Bell Labs, and he went to Merrimack College in Massachusetts, got involved with this site. He had built our home in Derry, and my mom was going to choke him, I think, about that time, because, you know, my sister was on her way, and so my dad had his hands full, you know, trying to do all that stuff at once, you know. But fortunately, you know, we still have this place. It's going to be 70 years. Next year will be 70 years ago my dad got involved.
Wow.
With it. So almost 70 years for our family. You know?
Thank God bless you.
And then the Pearsons before that.
Yeah.
And, you know, and all those people have to be given credit, because without everybody up to us, the site wouldn't be here today. Goodwin.
Yeah, thank you for preserving it.
Well, thank you. Thank you for people like you and the interest. That's, you know, that we love that. You know, that's what keeps this place here.
Yeah.
Without that, it's... You know, some days you just feel like nobody cares, you know.
I got some buddies from Kentucky and Indiana. They're going to be coming out probably next year. I want to bring them up here.
Bring them out here, because Indiana. And if they're in Indiana or anywhere near Mountain State Park, and I have some other people that just came last week, they live out there, and they were aware of Mound State Park, and there were mounds there.
Yeah.
But in the middle of the White River, I have a picture from 100-something years ago. It looks like our S-shaped serpent wall. It's right in the river, and you
can... I think I was there last year, because they brought me to a lot of mounds in Indiana and to Kentucky, too.
So. In Kentucky, too, yeah. But if you can get back there and talk to them, I did call their visitor center, and the woman goes, I don't know anything about any of these... serpent wall going through our river here. I said, I know, I Googled it and went down the river in Google Maps. Mm-hmm. You can't see it. There's an airport there and everything. I'm wondering if the Google Maps was taken when the water was high and you can't see it. But these people, that they said, you know, I think part of it's still there, but it's been damaged. I said, it looks like our S-shaped serpent. It's right in the middle of the river.
Yeah.
It's, and now I'd like to find some really good pictures, but also somebody who did a report on that and why... You can't see it today, you know?
Yeah.
I don't think it's any conspiracy, but it could have been like a flood. It could have been people took the rocks out because they wanted a canoe down there, and I'm sure it would have been in the way of boating.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's the answer. Maybe nothing to do with that.
Yeah.
I don't want to say that, but I'm wondering, just questions I have in my mind, that's all it is. And I'd like to find out why, because that looks like one of the serpent, one of the serpents we have here, and it looks like an S-shaped serpent. You know?
Yeah.
And it's like, wow. And they have mounds, earthen mounds, you know?
So interesting
back
stuff.
There, Dan, you got to check that out for me.
Awesome.
I still want to find out. And we did drive through Indianapolis on the way out to St. Louis, and we just didn't quite have enough time. We did a we did an 18-state, 3,700-mile loop, and we were heading towards Cahokia at that time, but we were in just south of Indianapolis, kind of south of there.
Yep.
And I think Mound State Park was like over here. I'm like, I don't think we're going to have time to go up there, you know, because we came up, we hit all Alabama, you know, Arkansas.
Yep.
We came down to Georgia. We were going to actually try to stay on the coast, the Gulf Coast, but we ran out of time. We didn't even hit that. We wanted to camp there because my wife had seen enough mounds by then. You know, 2 weeks of mounds,
yep.
And we love them. My dog, she's a little Nova Scotia duck tolling retriever. We took her to Newfoundland last year, but she actually loved, because some of the mounds you're able to walk up on, it's permitted. Some of them, I suppose, the conical ones, they're burial. Maybe they're more, a little bit more sacred, maybe, I think. People used to walk on them in the old days, but... Also, when you walk on them, it causes some damage. You know, your feet can cause erosion. So that's another thing. But some of these have boardwalks. You can actually visit them.
Yeah.
My dog just loved those things. They call it nothing but a mound dog, you know?
Yeah.
A hound dog. Well, anyway.
All right.
Yeah. Dan, yeah.
Was it that way?
Yeah, right through that gate.
Yep.
The site is right there. I think you can see the platform. The North Stone is just to your left when you go through that red gate there.
Yep.
And you go into the main site. It will be right in the back gate. You will see the cable. When you go back, if you want, you can go down by the building again. You can actually, maybe I can, if I'm down there, I'll walk up and show you the undulation. You get a good shot with that.
All right, cool. Thanks,
Dan,
Dennis.
I'll see you in a little bit.
Dude. Yep.
Yeah. All right.
I think my brother got lost somewhere.
It's like never ending this year. This grass here is never ending, you know?
So, oh, man.
Yeah,
good luck.
It's good retirement. Well, ever since they did the forestry project, we've never had so much grass and vegetation in our forests. They actually, a similar company... did 100 acres of North Stony, and they did it in 2018, and the licensed forester in Connecticut came to the NARA meeting and explained how walls are getting damaged and structures are getting damaged by trees. Trees are good, we like trees, but when they're on top of a chamber and they fall, they rip the chamber all to pieces, or in a wall, when they either fall on the wall or if they're next to it, they uproot, and they can cause a complete destruction of the wall. So what they try to do here is remove trees near the walls. That was one.
Yeah, it's a good idea.
They didn't know it was accomplished yet because just the way the wall did it. And we started ours a year after that. When we heard good news about what they did, we said, well, we're going to do that here for sure, you know. So,
all right. Well, thank you, Dennis.
Yeah, I'll see you in a little bit.
All right. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
I think Jason got lost. Jason! Jason like took off. So we're gonna go to see the sacrificial table. Alright, so that was that guy Dennis I told you about. So a lot of information, awesome stuff. So talk about aliens and serpent mountains and all kinds of cool stuff like that. So it's amazing how significant all over the world with this ancient serpent worship, which goes back to the Garden of Eden, you know. It's like, it's amazing. Just brings the scripture and history, you know, together. So we're looking for number 31. So we're going to go see the sacrificial table where sacrifices, I guess, took place on. Then we're going to go see the serpent. And the guy, Darryl, he was talking about, is a friend of mine. He's a Native American and all that. So for number 31. I think that might be it here. We're supposed to be up here, but again, we're looking for 31. So it's 20. So this is the chamber he was talking about. Country. Taking a scenic route.
Down,
We're in Salem, New Hampshire at the American Stonehenge. The Jason got lost somewhere in there. That was a good conversation with Dennis. A lot of information. See the wall just curving around. So I'm back. I had to text my brother. Say you got lost, he's back at the visitor center. So we'll take you inside the visitor center and I'll show you the artifacts I got in there on display. There's a lot of sundials over here. A lot of monoliths. The llama. It's Michael Jackson over there. All right, so we're at that point here. I think this is the wall he's talking about. The wall that just serpentines around the place. See, actually, it's like serpentines around the place, goes all the way up there. So I take you inside and show you the visitor site here. They have things on display. Oh, there you are. We found them.
I got lost.
So you see a lot of artifacts in here. What they found. It's an old axe right there.
More pair of sunglasses. A pair of glasses there, the keys, scissors.
It's the stuff they found at the site here. Flight tool. Native American pottery. This is the thing we talk about in Newport. Here's the Wamsutta right there. That's the Wamsutta cornerstone. The curator, he's this guy he didn't even know at the time. It's me and Chief Green told him what it was.
You're still live, live, live?
Yep. Live, live, live. All right, guys, so we're done. I couldn't find it. I'm sure we got a picture of it. The sacrificial table.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, couldn't find it somewhere up there. So we've been here a while, so we're a little tired. Anyway, guys, we'll probably be back on a little while if we decide to go into Salem, Mass or not. So, yeah, we'll see you in a little bit. So, Dan and Jason Bedondi, live in Salem, New Hampshire, at the American Stonehenge. So guys, yeah, come up and see this place, and it's pretty cool. Just shows you a lot of ancient history that you don't learn about in school. yeah, it's crazy, and yeah, it just defies everything in history books that you learn in school. The Rockefeller-funded school system, I should say. All right, guys, love you all. God bless, and we'll see you.